Chapter 24. Every flagstone gleamed. Every imperial column had been scrubbed white. Every colorful banner representing the Empire's most loyal worlds hung absolutely straight, displayed without a wrinkle. Everything was in order at the main citadel of the Imperial Military Academy on Carita. Ambassador Fergan nodded. Just the way he liked it. 300 crack stormtroopers stood at attention in the echoing hall, motionless in perfect ranks. Their white armor glistened like polished bone. They were identical, intensively trained, precise military machines. These stormtroopers were the best of the best in the academy. Only the top Imperial recruits even began stormtrooper training, and these 300 had excelled in every way. Ambassador Fergan moved toward the podium to address them. The smell of oils and waxes on the synthetic wood seemed potent in the otherwise sterilized air. Fergan drew himself up, trying to look larger than his stocky stature allowed. The white helmets turned in unison to track him with their black goggles. "Imperial troops," he said, "you have been chosen to lead the most important mission since the fall of our beloved Emperor. You have endured hardship and passed many tests during your training. I have chosen you as the elite, the best trainees remaining on Carita." They did not stir, did not congratulate each other. They remained like ranks of statues, which itself attested to the thoroughness of their training. Since receiving the long-awaited coordinates of the secret planet Anoth, Fergan had plotted this operation with extreme caution. He had studied the personnel data of thousands of his best troops. He had analyzed the records of their training exercises, mock combat in the harsh ice caps of Carita, prolonged sieges out in the baked and waterless deserts, jungle survival tours through dense and uncharted rainforests filled with primitive predators, carnivorous plants, and poisonous insects. Fergan had culled the names of those stormtroopers who had shown the most stamina, the most initiative, the greatest success, coupled with the strongest willingness to follow every order. He was proud of his assault force. "We have obtained secret information regarding the location of a certain baby. A child with enormous potential for using the force." He paused, expecting to hear them groan, but the stormtroopers made no sound. "This child is the son of Leia Organa Solo, the New Republic's Minister of State. If we were to apprehend this child, it would deal an enormous psychological blow to the rebellion, but beyond that, this boy is the grandson of Darth Vader." There, finally, he thought he heard a rustle of superstitious fear or awe. This child could be extremely valuable to the rebirth of the Empire. A child such as this, raised properly and trained properly, could become a worthy successor to the Emperor Palpatine. Fergan kept talking, faster now as he felt the excitement within him. He was more than just an ambassador, he planned to go along on this assault himself. He would not expose himself to any part of the attack, of course, but he would be there to snatch the young child named Anakin. "Your unit leaders will provide you with specific assignments. This expedition is currently being provisioned. We have secured transports to take you to the secret location of this world." Fergan allowed himself a broad grin with his thick purplish lips. "It is also my pleasure to announce that this assault will mark the first combat use of our new mountain terrain armored transports on which you have been training these past months. That is all. Hail to the Emperor." The thunderous response of filtered stormtrooper voices came back at him, rocking the hall. "Hail to the Emperor." Fergan slipped behind the hanging purple curtains into a walkway that led down empty glow-lit corridors toward his secure office. Inside his chambers he closed the blast-proof door and sealed it with a cipher lock. He brushed aside models and plans of the deadly new MTAT attack vehicles. He felt immensely pleased with himself and eager for the assault to start. Sitting on Carita during the years of turmoil, Fergan had been upset with all the squabbling Imperial commanders since the Emperor's death. Many of the warlords in the core systems were extremely powerful, yet they spent their time wrestling for dominance among the remnants of the Imperial fleet rather than fighting against their real enemy, the Rebellion. Grand Admiral Thrawn had seemed their greatest hope, but he had been defeated, and a year later even the resurrected Emperor had been defeated. The power vacuum of leadership left the Imperial forces with no leadership, no goal, battling only for their own advancement. Even this surprise new threat by renegade Admiral Daala disturbed Fergan. At least Daala was putting her Star Destroyers to an appropriate use, attacking rebel worlds and creating as much havoc as possible. But Daala had no overriding plan, no strategy that would bring her ultimate success. She was simply a juggernaut, striking target after target for the satisfaction of causing pain. Fergan had discovered to his surprise that Daala herself had been trained on Karida. Digging through old records, he had uncovered many disciplinary actions taken against her, reprimands in her file. Even then she had been a maverick, performing admirably but refusing to learn her place, insisting that she deserved promotions instead of others. Fergan had no record of her advancement to admiral, but Moff Tarkin had transferred her to his personal staff after one of his brief inspection tours. Fergan had no other information about Daala since that time. It angered him that this admiral continued her attacks on the rebellion without even attempting to get in touch with Karida. Perhaps Daala considered herself a vigilante, but the Empire needed its soldiers to fight as parts of an immense whole. The Empire did not need vigilantes. Fergan had tried to contact some of the other battling Imperial commanders to get capital ships for his assault on Anoth. The Emperor and Grand Admiral Thrawn and other depredations had already taken most of the ships available to Karida. On the military training planet, Fergan had access to some of the most sophisticated weaponry and soldiers in the entire galaxy, but because of the perpetual squabbles between the Imperial Army and the spacefaring Imperial Navy, he had no place to go with his troops. This left Fergan in a position of being on the most heavily armed, but useless, planet still loyal to the Empire. Fergan absently played with one of the articulated models of the MTAT fighting vehicle. It would be fascinating to see the marvelous new machine in operation. Even with the death of the Emperor, his loyalty to the Empire and the New Order had never been shaken, not even slightly. Fergan kept doing his best to strike vital blows against the New Republic, one way or another. He was pleased to watch indirect reports that gave him evidence of the inexorable progress of Mon Mothma's mysterious illness. She would be dead before long. And as soon as Fergan had the grandson of Darth Vader in his possession, all those still loyal to the Empire would have to listen to him. Chapter 25. When Wedge Antilles wasn't looking, Kwee-Zux stole a glance at the coordinates displayed on his navigation panel. Sitting in the co-pilot seat of the disguised personal space yacht, Kwee used her nimble fingers to tap the coordinates into the navicomputer, requesting a full display. Wedge looked away from the starfield and caught what she was doing. "Hey," he said, then grinned sheepishly as he lowered his gaze. This was supposed to be a surprise. Kwee laughed, a cascade of short musical tones. "I just wanted to know the name of the planet." She frowned as the display came up. "Ithor? Never heard of it." Wedge chuckled and reached over to squeeze her slender shoulder. She felt the warmth of his touch linger for several moments after he removed his hand. "Kwee, you've never heard of most places in the galaxy. You spent your entire life cooped up in Maw installation. Is Ithor a nice place?" she asked. He sighed. "It's beautiful. A pristine natural world covered with forests and jungles, rivers and waterfalls. We'll be incognito, and you won't have to worry about anybody knowing who you are." Kwee looked around at the metal-edged control panels of the space yacht, at the synthetic fabric of the seats that felt so smooth and soft. She smelled the recirculated air. Kwee had lived for years inside a completely enclosed environment, she knew nothing about plants and animals and other life forms. She hoped it would be fascinating. "Are you sure we'll be safe?" she asked, swallowing hard. Her greatest nightmare was that some Imperial spy might recapture her and haul her back to the Black Hole Research Lab where they would tear the weapon's knowledge out of her head, no matter how much she resisted. "Yes," Wedge said after a long pause. "Ithor is an isolated paradise. It's a world where many young couples," he paused, then swallowed as if embarrassed by the word he had just spoken, tourists go for vacations. Many people come and go, and the Ithorians welcome everyone. The Empire blockaded this world during the rebellion, causing some damage as a show of force. But after one of the Ithorians gave the Empire access to the agricultural and cloning information they wanted, Ithor was basically left alone. Wedge looked out at the starfield where the brilliant sun of the Ithorian system gleamed a whitish blue. He increased the thrust from the sublight engines and vectored them toward a bright green planet veined with blue and swathed with white clouds. "Just pretend we're on vacation," Wedge said. "We'll be tourists, and I'll show you what you've been missing. I can't think of a better place to start. I really look forward to it." Quee smiled warmly at him. Wedge blushed, then seemed to concentrate furiously on the relatively simple task of entering a low orbit. Quee placed her pale blue fingers against the side viewport as she stared at the lush vistas below. She had never seen such exotic scenery before, so different from the sterile white-walled rooms in Maw installation. Below her, between the treetops of a tropical paradise, broad rivers furled with white rapids as the current flowed over broken rocks. The space yacht soared above broad meadows splattered with brilliant colors, blooming flowers in red and yellow, blue and purple. The sheer vibrancy of the growing things dazzled her eyes. They passed over a chain of oval lakes that glittered and reflected the sunlight, like the string of jewels on the necklace Wedge had given her as a gift a few days earlier. Overhead the sky was a muted lavender. "Beautiful," she said. "Told you so," Wedge agreed, giving her a half smile. "You can trust me." She looked at him, then blinked her indigo eyes. "Yes, Wedge, I trust you." He cleared his throat and turned away quickly, pointing out the front viewport. "The Ithorians allow no damage to their environment," he said as if reading a data summary. "In fact, they consider it sacrilege even to set foot on the ground of their mother jungle." "Then how do they live?" Quee asked. "Look," Wedge said. As they soared above the treetops, Quee made out a strange shape coming over the horizon, rapidly growing larger as they approached. "Is that a city?" she said. "More than just a city," Wedge said, "an entire enclosed environment. The Ithorians call it the Tafanda Bay." The enormous disc-shaped construction swelled to fill their front viewport, looking larger and larger, and larger, like a fat coin greater in diameter than the entire Maw installation. Though the city appeared to be made of plasteel, it also seemed at least partially alive. A chaos of platforms, flight decks, transmission antennas, and roving machinery studded the hull of the Ithorian floating city, but the exposed surfaces were covered with hanging moss. Large trees grew out of special pockets on the side walls, rising to the sky and looking thicker and greener than the metallic towers. On the top flat surface of the disc, greenhouse domes sparkled like a thousand eyes in the sun. Quee could see through the transparent domes to dense botanical gardens in carefully manicured rows. Small ships flitted like gnats about the landing ports and shipping bays. Underneath the Tafanda Bay, banks of diffused repulsor lift engines kept the entire city hovering over the treetops, casting an elliptical shadow over the leafy surface. The Ithorian city slowly drifted along a wandering course with no destination in particular, without touching the sacred ground. Wedge keyed in his request for landing coordinates and was answered by an odd echoing voice that Quee thought sounded like someone speaking through a long, empty tube. After a moment the comm system crackled again with the voice, or was it another one, changing the coordinates? "Excuse us for the oversight, sir. A special representative will meet you at the landing bay. We hope you enjoy your stay here on our homeworld." Wedge looked suspiciously at the comm unit. "Why would they be giving us special treatment?" he said to Quee. "Nobody is supposed to know who we really are." Quee looked around, and suddenly the cockpit of the space yacht seemed smaller. "Do you think we're in danger? Should we turn around and find some other place to go?" Wedge looked as if that was indeed what he wanted to do. "No, it's all right," he said bravely. "I can protect you. Don't worry." They landed on the pad indicated, and Wedge extended the passenger ramp. He climbed down the gangway first and reached up to take Quee by the hand, leading her gently down. She could easily have disembarked by herself, but she enjoyed the attention he showered on her. Surrounding the space yacht were wide-boled gray-barked trees with low branches that spread out to form a long, flat platform. Brilliant white and blue flowers spangled the leaves. Staring around her, Quee took a deep breath of the moist air. Everything smelled fresh and alive, filled with a symphony of scents that startled her imagination. "Greetings." Quee turned to see an exceedingly strange-looking alien hulking toward them, flanked by 2 10-year-old human boys. The hunchbacked alien wore a white cape trimmed with braid. Its head looked like a long ladle, as if someone had taken a face made of soft clay and stretched it into an S-curve, looping the front up and yanking out 2 eye stalks. The mouth was hidden far under the sloping canopy of its head. As Quee watched, the cumbersome-looking creature took steps forward with a gentle, careful grace. The 2 human boys beside the creature wore similar white capes, over bright green jumpsuits. Pale-haired and blue-eyed, both wore beatific expressions, but neither of them spoke. Wedge must have seen how startled Quee was by the alien's appearance. "I guess I should have warned you. The Ithorians are commonly called hammerheads." Quee nodded slowly, thinking about other strange creatures she had seen, from the fish-faced Admiral Ackbar to the tentacle-headed Tol Sivrin who had run Maw installation. Perhaps not all intelligent creatures in the galaxy could be as attractive as some humans, such as Wedge. "Actually," the alien said, stepping closer, "we dislike the name hammerheads. It seems deprecating to us." "My apologies, sir," Wedge said, bowing slightly. "I am Momwa Naden, and I am honored to be of service to you, Wedge Antilles and Quee Zux." Wedge took 1 step back in panic. "How do you know our names?" he said. Momwa Naden made a hollow bubbling sound that came from both sides of his mouth in a stereophonic echo. "Mon Mothma asked me to give you special accommodations." "Why would Mon Mothma tell you we were coming here?" Wedge said. "We're supposed to be keeping a low profile." As Naden gave a slight bow, his ladle-shaped head seesawed up and down. "I have sympathized with the Rebel Alliance since my days of exile on Tatooine, more than a decade ago. My people banished me to the desert planet, where I could tend the sands rather than our beautiful forests. The Empire had demanded certain agricultural information, and I gave it to them to save our forests from being obliterated, but still my people exiled me. I returned here after the Emperor's death, and I have continued to make amends ever since." Naden gestured to the 2 human boys. "Take their luggage. We will show them their staterooms." The youths moved in unison, without the pell-mell franticness of young boys, entering the space yacht and returning with the slick silvery containers of vacation clothes. Naden led them away from the landing bay, ducking his head under the low-hanging branches that surrounded the landing pad. The passage seemed like a living green tunnel. "I was also in the cantina in Mos Eisley when Luke Skywalker and Obi-Wan Kenobi first met Captain Solo. I did not know my brush with history at that time, but I remember it clearly, though I was preoccupied with other concerns at the time." "I'm amazed you could recall a meeting like that after so many years," Wedge said. Naden indicated a disguised turbolift that opened like a great leafy pod in the wall. They all stepped inside and began to descend deeper within the Tafanda Bay. After a long pause, Naden finally said, "Ithorians have long memories." He led them through winding corridors, past small domes that contained specimens of plant life from different parts of the planet. Near a delicately spraying fountain, Naden pointed to 2 doors across the corridor from each other. "I have assigned you these staterooms," he said. "Please contact me if you desire other amenities. I am here to serve you." The 2 mysterious boys deposited the luggage in the corridor and stepped back to stand on either side of Naden. Quee finally said, "You haven't introduced us to the children. Are you their caretaker?" Naden made a rumbling bubbly sound in his twin throats. "They are seedlings, grown from the flesh of my enemy. They are also a memory of my days on Tatooine. Naden hung his ladle-shaped head. The two boys remained impassive, and Naden ushered them off. Without a backward glance, he left Wedge and Quee standing outside their staterooms, wondering what he meant. After nightfall, on the upper observation deck of the Tafanda Bay, Quee went with Wedge to watch the moon's rise. The lavender skies had turned a deep violet, punctuated by brilliant stars in a wash across the heavens. A small moon in full phase climbed over the eastern horizon, while the fingernail crescent of a much larger moon hung close to the western sky, following the brilliant colors of sunset over the edge of the world. High up, two other moons showed swollen quarter phases. Quee took a deep breath of the humid air, smelling a plethora of spicy perfumes from green plants and night-blooming flowers, like a complex mixture of all the perfumes and all the pleasant cooking herbs she had ever smelled. The breeze grew paradoxically warmer with nightfall, and she felt her feathery hair drifting about. She straightened it with her slender fingers, knowing that Wedge liked to see her pearly strands glisten in the light. She had changed into a soft wrap swirled with pastel colors that accentuated the ethereal beauty of her wispy body. The Ithorian eco-city cruised slowly over the treetops. The gentle hum of the Tafanda Bay's banks of repulsor-lift engines blended with the simmering night sounds of the jungle below. The breeze rustled leaves in the tall hedges and stands of scale trees around the observation deck. Other Ithorians arrived, standing in silence or thrumming in their strange stereo language. Wedge and Quee said nothing to each other. She stepped closer, brushed against him, then finally let herself snuggle up to his side. Nervously, it seemed, Wedge slipped an arm around her waist and she, Quee Zux, inventor of the Suncrusher, co-creator of the Death Star, felt honored to be under the protection of General Wedge Antilles. She knew that Imperial loyalists would be desperate to regain the secret knowledge locked in her brain. But Quee realized that here, at least, she felt completely safe. Chapter 26. Jason and Jaina continued their trek across Coruscant's dank underbelly. They couldn't tell if the dim half-light that filtered down from high above signified nighttime or day. The air smelled thick with rotted garbage, dead things, corroded metal, and stagnant water. They walked along the widest streets, dodging rubble, clambering over fallen and ancient wreckage. They had seen nothing familiar for hours, and neither of them knew what to do next. "I'm hungry," Jaina said. "Me too," Jason said. The deep underground was smothered in a silence overlaid with white noise. Shadowy creatures, startled by the twins, fled into darker hiding spots. Bumping one pile of debris, Jason and Jaina sparked an avalanche of frightening clatters. The twins ran from the noise, generating further junkfalls that tinkled and clanged from great heights. "My feet hurl," Jason said. "Mine don't," Jaina answered. Up ahead they finally saw a welcome sign, a cave dwelling made of shored-up wreckage, walls built from piled chunks of duracrete mortar together with a paste of dried algae, mud, and darker substances. Smoky lights burned deep inside the cave, looking enticing in contrast to the forbidding bleakness of the undercity. Jason and Jaina moved forward at the same time. "Food?" Jason asked. His sister nodded. Outside of the strange slumped cave they saw cables running through lichen-clogged eye bolts mounted at various points. Along the walls and ceilings, metal bands like long finger bones dangled in a decoration, linked together by sagging segments of chain. "In here," Jaina said, taking the lead. Dimness folded over them, leading them toward the enticing lights. Near her head a scratching, scuttling sound came from the shadows. The girl looked to see an elongated spider roach nearly the size of her head. Bumping against her, Jason leaned forward to get a better look at the creature. The spider roach clambered up the lumpy wall and hesitated, turning three glassy amber eyes at them. Suddenly, with a ratcheting clatter, a fistful of metal flanges from the ceiling swung loose like a prehensile mechanical hand dangling on chains. Dozens of steel fingers slammed against the wall to trap the spider roach, clamping it into a makeshift metallic cage. The creature thrashed and flailed, clacking its mandibles. Sparks flew as Chitinous forelimbs scrabbled against the impenetrable bars. In panic, Jason and Jaina hurried down the tunnel toward the flickering orange lights. But the twins stopped, simultaneously sensing a thrill of danger. They looked up just in time to see a much larger cage, all prongs and sharp metal edges, collapse down around them. Mechanical metal claws surrounded them like dozens of fists chained together. "Trap," Jaina said. Shuffling footsteps came toward them, a thud, then a scrape as a large hulking creature emerged from the depths of the lair. The silhouette appeared first, a massive tufted head with enormous arms dragging almost to the ground. One thickly muscled thigh looked the size of a tree trunk, but the other leg was much shorter, twisted and withered. Jason and Jaina rattled the sharp metal edges of the cage, but the mechanical claws drew tighter together like scissors. "Help," Jason said. Then their captor came into full view, lit from the side by reflected smoky lights. The creature was covered with a pelt of shaggy hair, showing no distinction between its enormous head and the rest of its torso, as if both pieces had been smashed together into one barrel-shaped mass. The thing's mouth hung in a long crooked slash, twisted sideways and straightened back only partway. Its left eye was overgrown with a mass of tumors and rotting flesh, the other eye, nearly as large as the twins' fists, shone a sickly yellow, streaked with red lines. Jason and Jaina were too afraid to say anything. Their ogre-like captor shambled past, ignoring them for the moment as he rocked back and forth on his stubby withered leg. He picked up the small trap to inspect the frantic spider roach. The children could smell the stink from the monster as he next bent toward the bars of their cage, thrusting his giant yellow eye close, but Jason and Jaina scrambled to the other side of the cage. The ogre disconnected long chains from the wall, draped them over his shoulder, and dragged the twins' cage clattering down the corridor into his firelit den. The cage rolled and crashed against unseen obstacles, and the twins had to scramble to keep themselves upright. Inside, gnawed bones from large and small creatures cluttered the monster's lair, some piled in baskets, others cracked and strewn over the broken floor. Smoky red flames came from smoldering pots filled with a rancid-smelling fat. Chained in a cleared area of the pit sat a tusked rat-like creature covered with bristling fur. Its black rubbery lips stretched back in a perpetual snarl. Gobbets of drool flew from its mouth as it snarled and threw itself to the end of its chain. A set of broken manacles from a detention area hung on the spike-encrusted walls of the chamber. As the ogre moved about in the brighter light, tatters of an old prison uniform could be seen among his greasy curls of body hair. The ogre pried open the metal fingers of the small spider roach trap. He picked up the arachnid with his lumpy bare hands and tossed it to the giant rat monster. The glossy spider roach flailed its long legs as it tumbled end over end, and the rat monster snapped it out of the air. But the bug managed to grab onto the rubbery lips with its sharp legs, and it stung hard. The rat creature yelped, gnashing its tusks until it chomped down and split the exoskeleton of the spider roach with a cracking pop. Then, contented, it slurped the juicy soft meat and licked its black lips. The rat creature panted and rolled its wet red eyes at the two children. Hopeful, the twins peered out from the cage. "We are lost," Jaina said, calling to the ogre from between the bars. "Please help us find our home," Jason added. The ogre fixed its yellow eye on them. A foul wet stench came from his mouth, like slime scraped from the bottoms of a thousand sewers. He spoke in a bubbling voice, slurring the words. "No," the ogre said. "Gonna eat you." Then he tottered off on his shriveled leg toward a smoldering fireplace. The ogre found a pair of long sharp tongs resting in the hot coals. Holding the implements high, the ogre turned back to the twins. Jason and Jaina both looked at the top of their cage. The articulated finger joints were held together by small pins clogged with grease and rust, but smooth enough that the cage could open and close. The twins each knew which pins the other concentrated on, and used their rudimentary ability with the Force, just as they did when they played tricks on 3PO and played the games that their Uncle Luke showed them. They popped out the cage pins two at a time in rapid succession. Small pieces of metal flew like tiny projectiles in all directions. Suddenly, without support, the long metal fingers fell open to the ground with an incredible clang. "Run!" Jason cried. Jaina took his hand and they scrambled toward the tunnel. The ogre let out a furious roar and stumped after them, but he could not keep up on his uneven legs. Instead, he grabbed the thick chain holding the rat monster to the wall and yanked out the long spike that held its collar together. Set free, the rat creature lunged. Turning, it tried to snap its teeth at the ogre, but he used a muscle-swollen arm to bash the rat thing away from him. He gestured toward the fleeing children. And they ran, and they ran. The rat creature came howling and slavering after them. The twins ran out of the firelit opening and dashed down an alley. Behind them they could hear the steam engine sounds of the creature as it snorted, following their scent. Its claws clattered on the pavement. Jaina found a small dark gash in the wall, a hole broken into the layered duracrete. "Here," she said. Jaina dived into the tiny hole headfirst, and her brother clambered after. Only a second later the rat creature jammed its tusked snout against the jagged opening, but it could not get its head through the hole. By that time Jason and Jaina had scrambled on their hands and knees, burrowing deep into the unexplored darkness. "Oh, we never should have agreed to babysit," 3PO wailed. "I wonder how often babysitters actually lose their children." Chewbacca growled at him. "Why didn't you listen to me, Chewbacca? Mistress Leia will have all your fur shaved off so she can make a new rug. You will be the first bald Wookiee in history." Chewbacca bellowed a suggestion as they stormed down the corridors, still searching the holographic zoo for extinct animals. "You can go to the control room if you like. I think we should sound the alarm here and now. It is perfectly acceptable to summon help. This is an emergency." 3PO found the fire alarm and activated it with one golden hand. Next, he searched among the holographic exhibits until he also found a security alarm. Without hesitation, he pressed the button. "There, that should do it." Chewbacca growled in 3PO's face with enough force that the droid's audio sensors shut down to reset themselves. Then he manhandled 3PO in his furred Wookiee arms, carrying him bodily down the hall at a fast lope. "All right, have it your way, then," 3PO said. "We'll go to the control center and shut down all the holograms." Jason and Jaina felt the slimy surface of the tunnel as they crawled downward. They had no idea where they were going, but they knew they had to find some other way home. Jason reached up, felt no close ceiling, and climbed to his feet. The twins could see nothing in the darkness, only a faint glow ahead. They made their way toward it, cautiously this time, afraid they might find another ogre. Jason smelled sizzling meat, and he heard guttural words, the first human voices they had heard since deciding to go home without 3PO and Chewbacca. Jason started toward the light, but Jaina held on to his arm. "Careful," she said. Jason nodded and put a finger to his lips as a reminder. They inched forward, hearts hammering. They smelled the delicious scents of cooked food, heard the crackle of fire, the chattering voices. They reached a corner and peered around it to see a large blasted-out room, a low-level reception area used thousands of years ago. Jason and Jaina could see a bonfire, tattered figures moving between light and shadow, banks of dimly functioning glow crystals, and a glimpse of blinking computer equipment. Then suddenly, from all sides, silent hands reached out to grab them. Firm grips, wiry arms. 5 sentries struck at once, snatching Jason and Jaina and whisking them off their feet before they had a chance to struggle. The sentries laughed even as the children squealed in terror. A cheer went up from the people around the bonfire, as the sentries carried the twins out into the bright light. Alarms pulsed and whooped in the control center of the holographic zoo. Red signals flashed, yellow lights blinked on and off in indecipherable patterns. 3PO was impressed at the commotion he had managed to cause just by activating a few security systems. The zoo's control droid sat in the center of an octagonal computer bank. It had a spherical head encircled by optical sensors mounted every 36 degrees. From its central station, the control droid sprouted 8 segmented limbs that scrambled over the panels, pecking at the buttons in a blur of motion like firelinked blaster cannons. "Permission denied," the control droid said to them. Chewbacca roared, but the control droid merely spun its spherical head and ignored the Wookiee's outburst. "I feel required to warn you," 3PO said to the other droid, "that when Wookiees lose their tempers they are known to rip limbs out of their sockets. I believe Chewbacca here is on the verge of losing his temper." Chewbacca leaned forward on one of the segmented control panels, gripped it with his hairy paws, and roared again into one set of the multiple eyes. "Permission still denied," the control droid said. "But you don't understand," 3PO insisted. "There are 2 lost children inside your holographic zoo. If you would just shut down the image generators, we could search the habitats and find them." "Unacceptable," the control droid said. "It would cause too great a disturbance among the other guests." 3PO indignantly propped his metallic arms on his hips. "But the zoo looked empty when we toured it. How many other patrons are currently using the facility?" "Irrelevant," the control droid said. "Such an action is strictly forbidden except in conditions of extreme emergency." 3PO waved his golden hands in the air. "But this is an emergency." Chewbacca had apparently had enough of formal requests. He bunched his fists together and brought them down on the first control bank, smashing the glossy black coverings and shattering circuit connections. Sparks flew. The control droid's head spun around like a planet knocked out of its orbit. "Excuse me," the control droid said, "please don't touch the controls." Chewbacca went to the second segment of the octagonal board and smashed it as well. The control droid flailed its 8 articulated limbs, trying to bypass circuits in the remaining systems. "I must admit, Chewbacca, that your enthusiasm makes up for any lack of finesse," 3PO said. In no time the Wookiee had ruined the entire set of panels. Without a single functioning hologram generating system, the control droid folded all 8 of its articulated arms like a dead insect and seemed to sulk. Chewbacca yanked 3PO's mechanical arm and hauled him back down to the holographic habitats. Now every chamber was empty, white-tiled walls with strategically mounted hologram generators at the vertices of the room. Various guests had dropped garbage in among the illusions, refreshment wrappers, torn scraps of paper, and half-eaten non-organic treats that had failed to decompose. "Jason! Jaina!" 3PO called. Alarms continued to squawk as Chewbacca and 3PO passed from one habitat to the next. 3PO called up the data brochure inside his computer brain and guided the search, methodically moving from one room to another. Every cell in the deactivated holographic zoo looked identical, and they found the children in none of them. When they finally hurried to the last chamber, hoping against hope that they would discover the twins crouched in the corner and waiting to be rescued, they were suddenly met by the New Republic militia charging toward them in response to all the alarms. "Halt," the captain of the guard said. 3PO instantly counted 18 humans, all wearing blasterproof armor. The militia members drew their weapons and leveled them. In all his adventures, 3PO couldn't recall ever having seen so many blaster barrels pointed directly at him. "Oh my," he said. The feral humans brought Jason and Jaina before their king. The flickering warmth of the junk heap bonfire made a pleasant smell. The strips of unrecognizable meat roasting on long skewers caused both children to lick their lips. Grimy-faced sentries looked down at the twins and smiled. Their mouths seemed like a checkerboard of yellow teeth and black gaps. The king of the underground humans sat on a tall pile of ragged cushions. He laughed. "These are the fearsome intruders." Jason and Jaina looked around themselves, gathering details. The refugees in the former reception area had bedrolls, tattered clothing, and stashes of scavenged possessions. Some sat mending rags, others worked on spring-loaded animal traps. Two old men crouched holding small musical instruments cobbled together from old pipes, they blew into the mouthpieces, comparing high whistling notes. The feral people wore torn and threadbare clothing, some mended, some not, all very old. They had long hair, the men wore bushy beards. Their skin was pale, as if they had not seen sunlight for decades. Some of them might never have seen natural light at all. The king seemed to have the best materials. He wore shoulder pads and polished white gloves taken from a stormtrooper. His eyebrows were large, his reddish-brown beard wispy. Though his face was the color of raw bread dough, his eyes were bright and alert. His smile also showed gaps from missing teeth, but it contained real humor. Around and behind the king hung jury-rigged electronic equipment, computer panels, holographic display modules, even one old model food processing unit. Ancient generators had been wired into the frayed energy grid of the skyscrapers, skimming power from the main flow through Imperial City. The lost people had obviously been down here a long time. "Get these children some food," the king yelled, bending down to look at them. "Well, now, my name is Dae Kim. What are your names?"
"Jaina," Jason said, indicating his sister.
Jaina pointed to her brother.
"Jason."
A sentry with gray blonde hair tied in a long ponytail brought a smoking skewer of the roasted meat. He yanked off the red-black pieces of meat with his fingers and dropped them onto a squarish metal platter that had originally been some sort of cover plate. The sentry blew on his fingers, licked the juices, and grinned at the children. He set the platter down in front of them, and the twins sat on the floor, crossing their legs.
"Blow on the meat before you put it in your mouths," the king said.
"It's hot." The twins picked up small morsels, dutifully blowing until the meat was cool enough to chew. King Dae Kim seemed to delight in just watching them.
"So what were you doing down here all alone?"
"It's dangerous, you know."
"Would you like to stay here with us?" the king said.
"We're all growing old. It's been too long since young people joined us down here." Jason and Jaina shook their heads.
"We are lost," Jaina said around a mouthful of meat. A thick welling of tears appeared on the edge of her eyelids.
Jason also started to cry.
"Please help us find our home," he said, looking toward the high ceiling.
Somewhere up in the distance lay their living quarters.
"Up there?"
King Dae Kim said, comically incredulous.
"Why would you want to go back up there?"
"The Emperor lives up there. He's a bad man." Dae Kim shook his head and gestured around him.
"We have everything we want here.
We have food, we have light, we have our things."
Jason shook his head at Dae Kim.
"I want to go home." With a sigh, Dae Kim glanced back at his banks of computer terminals and then flashed them a defeated smile.
"Of course you want to go home. Just finish up your supper. You'll need your strength."
The sergeant of the militia escorted 3PO and Chewbacca back to Han and Leia's quarters in the old Imperial Palace. "Our records indicate that Minister Organa Solo and her husband returned not more than an hour ago," the sergeant said. Chewbacca moaned dejectedly. 3PO shot a sharp glance at him.
"I think you should be the one to tell them what happened, Chewbacca.
After all, I'm only a droid."
"Rest assured we're doing everything we can," the sergeant said.
"We've had our teams combing the holographic zoo and the adjoining floors just in case the twins found an emergency staircase. We're checking the logs of the maintenance droid just to be sure that no one used the turbolift that was being serviced."
He snapped to attention.
"We'll find them, don't you worry." 3PO used the override code on the doorway to open it. Then he and Chewbacca stepped into the living quarters, to find Han and Leia sitting on the self-conforming chairs, with the twins balanced on their knees.
"Children.
Oh, thank goodness, you're home," 3PO cried. Chewbacca thundered a high-pitched bellow. Han and Leia both turned to look at them.
"Well, there you two are." 3PO noticed at once that one of the panels from the air ventilation system had been knocked off, apparently from the inside. A stranger, a large man, dressed in tattered but ornate clothing, dashed to shelter behind one of the larger pieces of furniture. He had long reddish-brown hair, a wispy beard, and uncommonly pale skin. Leia returned her attention to the rag-clad man. "Seriously, Mr. Dae Kim, I can't tell you how much we appreciate what you've done. I assure you the New Republic will do everything it can to repatriate all your people." Dae Kim shook his head. "The Emperor never forgave mistakes, not even accounting mistakes. We saw many of our fellow civil servants either executed or sent off to horrendous penal colonies. As soon as we caught ourselves in a simple but irrevocable filing error, we knew we didn't have long to live, so we grabbed what we could and fled to the underlevels of Imperial City. My people have been living there for years. We're just a bunch of feral bureaucrats who don't know any other life. We could find a place for you in the New Republic. We don't punish people for simple mistakes. We could bring you all back," Leia said again. "Look around you, we could give you your own quarters like these. Many of the buildings in the old Imperial City are abandoned." "We know," Dae Kim said, "we live there ourselves sometimes. Thank you for your offer." He stood up and cast a suspicious glance toward 3PO and Chewbacca. He patted Jason and Jaina on the head and flashed his gap-toothed smile. "You're good little children. Your mommy and daddy should be proud of you." Han cleared his throat and extended his hand in thanks. The tattered man grabbed it and shook vigorously as if pleased to give a firm, business-like handshake. "I still don't understand why you want to stay down in those murky lower levels," Han said. Dae Kim swung one leg into the ventilation duct and looked around. "It's very simple," he said. "Up here I was just a file clerk, down there I am a king." With a last smile for all of them, Dae Kim vanished into the ventilation ducts. They heard him thumping and scrambling as he disappeared down the access tubes. "Well, everything turned out right after all," 3PO said. "Isn't this wonderful?" In answer, Han and Leia both glared at him. "We want a story," the twins said in unison. Chapter 27. Kip-Diron brought his stolen ship into orbit around the small forest moon of Endor, where the second Death Star had been destroyed. Ignoring the sensors on board his stolen Z-95 headhunter, he let his eyes fall closed. He reached out with his sensibility, seeking across the entire landscape for shadows or ripples in the Force. He had to find the last resting place of the only other Dark Lord of the Sith he knew of. Darth Vader. Exar Kun, who had lived long before Vader, was pleased to know that the Lords of the Sith had continued for millennia. But Kip still felt driven to find answers to the clamoring questions in his mind. Master Skywalker said that Darth Vader, his own father, had returned to the light side in the end. From this, Kip concluded that the powers of the Sith were not permanently connected with evil. That gave him a thread of hope. He recognized full well that the dark spirit of Exar Kun had lied to him, or at least misled him. The risk was terrible, but the reward would benefit the entire galaxy. If he succeeded. Here on Endor, Kip felt he could hide from the watchful eyes of Exar Kun. He didn't know how far Kun's power extended, but he didn't think the ancient Sith Lord could leave Yavin 4. Not yet, at least. Kip instinctively worked the controls of Mara Jade's fighter, bringing the headhunter lower as he scanned the forests. After the rebel celebration of their victory over the Emperor, Luke Skywalker had built a pyre for his father near the towering trees, not far from the Ewok villages. He had watched the roaring flames consume the remnants of Darth Vader's mechanical attire. But perhaps something had survived. As the headhunter cruised over the tops of the immense Ewok father trees, Kip searched with his mind, ironically making use of the exercises Master Skywalker had taught him, how to reach out and touch all life forms. He caught the stirrings of the furry Ewoks in their tree cities. He sensed large predators on the prowl. One humanoid behemoth, a giant Gorax, crashed through the trees, black hair swinging from side to side as he searched for Ewok dwellings low enough to grab. As he flew onward, Kip's mind ranged far and wide across the indoor wilderness. Then he felt a ripple, an echo of something that definitely did not belong. Everything else seemed to have its place, but this did not conform. A stain that seemed to absorb all other senses, casting waves of leftover darkness that caused the creatures on Endor to avoid the place instinctively. Kip changed course and arrowed to the coordinates, circling once until he found an appropriate clearing. The repulsor lifts whined, and his landing jets kicked up fallen forest debris as he landed the headhunter in the underbrush. Afraid and yet eager, Kip swung out of the cockpit and hopped down, landing with a crunch in the twigs and dead leaves. The breeze died, as if the evening forest were holding its breath around him. Silvery planet shine trickled through the dense leaves, lighting the clearing with a wan, milky glow. Kip took four steps and stopped before the scorched site of Vader's funeral pyre. The ground surrounding the old burned area remained dead and brown. Though the thick forests of Endor were tenacious and fast-growing, no plants dared approach the scar, even after 7 years. The bonfire had been large and hot, incinerating Vader's uniform. Only a few heat-warped bits of body armor had survived, along with tatters of a black cape tangled in broken rocks and time-packed ashes. A twisted lacing of steel reinforcement lay like a torn spiderweb covered. Kip swallowed and knelt in the dirt. He reached out tentatively, afraid, until he let his fingertips brush the age-crumbled ashes. He jerked his hand away, then brought it back. The spot was cold, but the coldness seemed to go away as his hands grew numb. Kip used the force to scatter bits of ash, blowing clear the tiny, buckled residue that had survived the fire, an unrecognizable lump of black plasteel that might have been Vader's helmet. Growing more desperate, Kip increased his power, scouring away debris and leaving only a sad jumble of wires, melted plasteel, and shreds of tough cloth. Darth Vader, former Dark Lord of the Sith, had been reduced to only pathetic scraps and nightmarish memories. Kip reached out to stroke the remnants. Electric tingles went through his hands. He knew he shouldn't be touching these relics, yet he could not turn away now. Kip had to find answers to his questions, even if he had to answer them himself. "Darth Vader, where did you go wrong?" he asked, staring down at the fragments of armor. His voice, unused for more than a day, croaked at him. Vader had been a monster, with the blood of billions on his hands. According to Exar Kun, Anakin Skywalker had been unprepared for the power he had touched, and it had overwhelmed him. Kip recognized that he had begun to walk down a similar path, but he was not so naive. Unlike Anakin Skywalker, he understood the dangers. He could guard himself. He would not be tricked by the temptations and the brutalities that had lured Vader deeper and deeper into the dark side. Feeling cold and alone in the night, Kip returned to the ship and took out the long cape Han Solo had given him. He wrapped the fabric around his dark jumpsuit to keep warm, then went back to sit on the barren ground by the ashes of Vader's pyre. The peaceful sounds of the forest gradually returned, chirping and whistling around him like a lullaby. Kip was in no hurry. He could wait here on Endor. He needed to make sure he wasn't kidding himself. He was no fool. He knew the dangerous edge he was walking, and it frightened him. As he sat in peace, running his fingers along the slick, fine fabric of his cloak, Kip thought of how his friend Han Solo had freed him from the spice mines, but even that happy thought twisted around to make him realize just how much of his life the Empire had stolen from him. Kip rarely recalled the diamond-edged memories of his youth, when he and his older brother Zeth had lived on the colony world of Deer. He thought of the raft cities anchored in a complex of terraformed lakes stocked with fish. Zeth had taken him out many times on a pleasure skimmer to sink crustacean nets or just to swim under the ochre-colored skies. His brother Zeth had long dark hair, eyes narrowed against the brightness of the sun, his body wiry and rippling with lean muscles, his skin tanned from long days spent outside. The colonists had tried to build a perfect society on Deer, fully democratic with every person serving a term on the Council of Raft Towns. Unanimously, the representatives on Dayur had voted to condemn the destruction of Alderaan, to request that Emperor Palpatine rescind his new order. They had worked through the appropriate political channels, naively believing that with their votes they could influence the Emperor's decisions. Instead, Palpatine had crushed the dissidents on Dayur, overrunning the entire colony, scattering the people to various penal centers, and taking Zeth away forever. Kip found his hands clenched tight, and he thought again of the powers that Exar Kun had shown him, the dark secrets that Master Skywalker refused to consider. He frowned and took a deep breath. The cool night air bit into his lungs, and he let it out slowly. He vowed not to let Exar Kun twist him into another Vader. Kip felt confident in his determination, in his own strength of character. He could use the power of the dark side for the benefit of the New Republic. Master Skywalker was wrong. The New Republic stood on the moral high ground and was justified in using any weapon, any force, to eradicate the last stains of the evil empire. Kip stood up and wrapped the black cape around his chest. He could make amends. He alone could show how well those powers could be used. Exar Kun was long dead, and Darth Vader lay in ashes on Endor. "Now I am the Lord of the Sith," Kip said. With that admission, he felt a cold strength creep up his backbone, as if his spine had turned into a column of ice. He clambered back aboard his small spacecraft. The determination felt like flames in his feet, making him move, making his heart pound, focusing his resolution into a laser-bright beam. Now he, and he alone, had the opportunity to solve all of the New Republic's problems, by himself. Chapter 28. Reflected glows from the Cauldron Nebula made slow dancing patterns on the polished surface of the Gorgon's war room table. Admiral Daala sat alone at the far end, separated from Commander Kratos, Imperial Army General Odosk, and Captain Mullinor of the Basilisk. Daala stared at her own drawn and distorted reflection in the liquid sheen of the table. She kept her emerald eyes fixedly ahead as she squeezed her fist, feeling the supple black leather of her gloves. Her head pounded with a dull ache, like the imagined echoes of screaming troopers on the exploding manticore. Hot blood roared through her veins as she thought of how she had also lost the Star Destroyer Hydra. Half of her force obliterated. What would Tarkin think of her? In her nightmares, she pictured his specter drawing back his open hand to strike her across the face for her miserable failure. Failure. She had to make up for it. Commander Kratos drew his bushy eyebrows together in an expression of concern. His imperial cap rested against his short dark hair. He turned away from Daala's stare, then looked toward the general and the captain of the other Star Destroyer. No one spoke. They waited for Daala, and she tried to summon the courage to speak. "Gentlemen," she finally said. The words felt like rusty nails catching in her throat, but her voice was strong, startling the three commanders into attention. She eyed each one in turn, then swiveled her chair so she could gaze out at the seething cauldron gases. A knot of bright blue giant stars at the heart of the nebula poured out intense energy that illuminated the cloud of gas. "I have reassessed our mission." Daala swallowed. The words already sounded like defeat to her, but she would not give in to it. "We must somehow differentiate between conflicting priorities. Our original command from Grand Moff Tarkin was to protect the Maw installation at all costs. That is why we were given four Star Destroyers. Tarkin considered the scientists there a priceless resource for the ultimate victory of the Empire." She clenched her teeth and hesitated again. Her body betrayed her and started to tremble, but she gripped the edge of the polished table with her glove, gripped it hard until the cramped muscles in her fingers steadied her again. "But we allowed the Suncrusher, the most powerful weapon ever designed, to be stolen from our grasp, and we lost 1/4 of our fleet in a failed attempt to recapture it. Upon learning of the changed situation with the rebellion, I decided that it was more important to fight the enemies of the Empire. We left Maw installation undefended as we harried rebel worlds. Now, after the disaster at Calamari, I see we have failed in that too. Commander Kratos rose partway to his feet as if he felt compelled to defend her actions. His skin flushed darker, and Daala noticed a disgraceful hint of stubble on his jaw. If these had been normal disciplinary conditions inside Maw installation, she would have reprimanded him seriously. "Admiral," he said, "I agree that we've suffered severe losses, but we have also struck crushing blows against the rebel traitors. The assault on Dantooine." Daala's hand swung up to silence him with the finality of a vibro-axe. Kratos clamped his thin lips shut and slithered back into his chair. "I am fully aware of the battle statistics, Commander. I see the numbers in my sleep. I have studied the datapads over and over." Her voice rose and became molten with anger. "No matter how much damage we have done to the rebellion, their losses have been insignificant compared to ours." Then her voice dropped to such a sudden quiet coldness that she saw General Odosk's watery eyes widen in fear. "And so I intend to use my last resources in one final assault. If successful, it will fulfill both of our missions." Her gloved fingers worked the controls at the end of the table. From a hollow projector in the center of the black slab rose the computer-generated image she had worked up that afternoon in her private quarters, while the image of Grand Moff Tarkin droned on with his pre-recorded lectures. "I mean to stab at the heart of the rebellion," she said. "Coruscant itself." A high-resolution mapping of the last known surface topography of the Emperor's planet focused on a world-sized metropolis with frozen polar caps and sparkling chains of city lights on the night side of the planet. She saw space docks, curved solar mirrors that warmed the upper and lower latitudes of the planet, communications satellites, large freighters, streams of orbital traffic. Daala gestured, and two fully rendered images of her Star Destroyers appeared traveling side by side at high speed toward Coruscant. "I intend to take all ships and all personnel onto the Gorgon, leaving only a skeleton crew, of volunteers, of course, on board the Basilisk. Our Star Destroyers will come out of hyperspace just beyond the moons of Coruscant. We will drive in at full sublight speed, without hesitation, straight toward our target. We will give no warning, and we will fire every turbolaser battery we have, clearing a corridor to head directly for Imperial City. Any ship that stands in our way will become a cloud of ionized metal." As she spoke, the computer animation demonstrated her tactics. The two Star Destroyers arrowed toward the capital city of the New Republic. "The Calamarian commander who defeated the Manticore gave me an idea with his suicide run, and we shall turn the tables on them." Daala watched the stony face of General Odosk, the appalled look of disbelief on Captain Mullinor, and the stern support of Commander Kratos. "This will be our deadliest hit and run," Daala said. "It will cause enough damage for our names to live forever in the annals of Imperial history. We shall deal a death blow to the rebel government. As we approach in system, the Basilisk's small volunteer crew will begin a self-destruct countdown. The Gorgon will run interference until we reach our target, at which time we will turn aside. At full speed, the Basilisk will plunge into the atmosphere of Coruscant. It will be unstoppable." On the simulated image, one Star Destroyer split away before touching the skin of air, curving in a tight orbit around Coruscant and then streaking off into space as the first ship plummeted, flaming into the atmosphere toward the most heavily populated center on the planet. "When the Basilisk detonates," Daala said. She paused as the planetary image flashed with a brilliant ring of fire that sent ripples igniting through the atmosphere. All the lights on the night side of the planet went dark. Cracks of fire appeared across the land masses. "The explosion will be sufficient to level the buildings on half a continent. The shock wave traveling through the planetary core could topple cities on the other side of the world. The underground reservoirs will break open. Tidal waves will cause damage along the coasts. For the price of one Star Destroyer, we can lay waste to Coruscant." Odosk looked grimly admiring at the simulation. "A good plan, Admiral. But my ship," Captain Mullinor said. "It will be a glorious sacrifice," Commander Kratos said. He steepled his fingers and leaned across the polished table. "I agree." The simulated death of Coruscant continued, showing spreading fires across the cities, seismic disturbances and destruction that continued long after the Gorgon vanished into an incandescent spot of light in hyperspace. "But what of us?" Kratos said. "What will we do then?" Daala folded her arms across her chest. "We will accomplish both of our missions, as I said. When the Basilisk has destroyed Coruscant, the Gorgon and all of our personnel shall return to Maw installation, where we will defend it to the death with every resource available. The rebels know it is there, they will be sure to come sniffing around." Daala's need for vengeance forged her heart into a white-hot brand that threatened to burst its way steaming and pulsing out of her chest. "Grand Moff Tarkin once said that setbacks are merely an opportunity for us to do twice as much damage the second time around." Captain Mullinor looked even paler than usual, pinpricks of blood vessels speckled his milky white skin. His blonde hair had been cropped severely close to his head, making him seem bald in a certain light. "Admiral," he said, "let me volunteer to remain on board the Basilisk for this mission. I will be proud to captain my ship until the end." Daala looked at him and tried to determine if he sought some sort of compassion from her. She decided he wanted none. "I accept, Captain," she said. Mullinor sat down and gave a tight nod that jerked his chin toward his throat. Daala rose to her feet. The muscles in her thighs and back felt like tightly bundled wires. Her entire body had been a clenched fist since the debacle on Calamari, and she knew the only way to release the crushing tension would be to strike a devastating blow against the rebellion. "Begin the transfer of personnel and equipment," she said. "We must strike Coruscant at once." Daala glanced once more at the seething nebula that hit her ship, and then she left the war room. She headed to her quarters, where she would review Tarkin's tactical tapes, searching for lost and secret wisdom that would guarantee her victory. Chapter 29. The Calamarian female emerged from her teardrop-shaped transport pod, and swiveled her head as she took in the thick jungles of Yavin 4, the tall ancient temples. She waited. Luke hurried out of the hangar bay and tried to maintain a careful pace across the cleared landing area. R2 accompanied him across the packed ground. He noted that the Calamarian female had a smaller stature than Admiral Ackbar. She wore yellow and turquoise robes that hung loosely about her frame, sleeves that flowed like waterfalls. He sensed a sad determination from her. The Calamarian female saw Luke and gestured with a flipper hand to the unseen pilot of the transport pod. Behind her, the craft rose skyward with a magnetic hum, leaving her behind. She did not look up to watch the pod streak back into the low-lying clouds, but seemed intent on staying right where she was. "Master Skywalker," she said with a velvety burr that put him at ease. "I am Ambassador Silgal from Calamari. I have a message for you." She reached into one of her flowing sleeves and withdrew a gleaming disc traced with patterns of copper and gold. "R2. Luke said. The little droid trundled forward, and Silgal bent down to insert the message disc into R2's drive. After a momentary where R2 projected a flickering image of Leia in the air in front of him. Luke stood back surprised, then looked at Silgal with a deeper interest as Leia started speaking. "Luke, I hope all is well with you. I think I've found someone for your Jedi training center. Ambassador Silgal comes with my highest recommendation. She has demonstrated to my satisfaction that she has a true proficiency in using the Force. She seems to have a knack for healing and for short-range prediction. She was a great help during the recent battle on Calamari. Please help her and train her. We need more Jedi Knights." Her image smiled up at him. "We hope to hear soon that some of your students are ready to help with our struggle against the Empire. These are still desperate times. We can't let our guard slip for a moment." Her expression softened, and she seemed to look directly into his eyes. "I miss you. The twins keep asking when they'll see their Uncle Luke again. I hope you can visit, or maybe we'll come to Yavin 4. She straightened, taking a formal tone again. "I'm sure you'll find Silgal to be one of your most promising candidates. She crossed her arms and smiled as the message flickered and vanished. Silgo stood in silence, waiting for Luke to respond. His mind spun. Welcome, he finally said. He had been disturbed since his confrontation with Kip Duran. Luke did not know where the young man had gone after stealing Mara Jade's ship. The gruesome death of Gantoris, coupled with Kip's rebellion, had been more than enough to resurrect the old fear in Luke again. His best students were going sour, getting impatient, trying to push the limits of their abilities. But he had sensed a greater, deeper menace that vibrated within the very stones of the great temple itself, evil, and well hidden. Working alone, Luke had attempted to find its source, running his fingers along the stone blocks of the walls, trying to tap the cold shadow, but he had found nothing. He had only his suspicions. How could Kip have known the details of the Great Sith War? How could Gantoris have learned how to build his own lightsaber? What had Gantoris seen that last terrible night before he was consumed? What dreaded magic had he attempted? Luke was missing an important piece of the puzzle, and until he found it, he could not strike against the threat. Ambassador Silgul shifted and looked at him again. Master Skywalker, you seem preoccupied. Perhaps Leia was wrong in suggesting that I come here to stay. Luke looked at her, feeling the weight of responsibility on his shoulders. No, no, he said, that's not it. If Leia thinks you have Jedi potential, then I would be honored to teach you here. In fact, he said jokingly, an even-tempered Calamarian will be a welcome change. He smiled. Follow me. We'll find quarters for you inside the temple. The students at Luke's training center continued their lessons of self-discovery, working eagerly or meditatively, honing their skills. Newcomer Mara Jade listened intently to Silgul's first-hand descriptions of the attack on Calamari, pressing the ambassador with detailed questions about the Star Destroyers and the number of TIE squadrons they had carried. Old Streen sat next to Kirana T on a rounded bench, listening to silver-haired Tion practice new ballads. The remaining students sat in other common rooms, or studied in their private chambers, or walked out in the jungles. Satisfied at their activities, Luke slipped back into the deserted corridors and headed toward his own rooms. R2 came around the corner and whistled a question at him, but Luke shook his head. No, R2, I don't want to be disturbed for a while. He stepped inside his stonewalled chamber, the small room where he had stayed as an X-wing pilot in the Alliance. Luke had removed the other bunks, furnished the room to his taste, but the room seemed barren, with only a sleeping pallet and some small Masasi artifacts. On a ledge of black stone laced with blood-colored impurities sat the translucent cube of the Jedi holocron. Luke sealed his door, the first time he had ever locked it since returning to the abandoned temple. He held the holocron in his palm and activated it, digging deep to seek his information. I wish to see Master Vodosiask Bass, he said. The ghostly image of the nozzle-faced, stunted Jedi Master rose out of the cube, robed and covered with bangles, leaning on a long gnarled stick. I am the gatekeeper, I am Master Vodosiask Bass, the image said. Luke squatted in front of the interactive holographic image. I need information from you, Master Vodo. You were a Jedi during the time of the Great Sith War. You have told us about your student Exar Kun and how he created the Brotherhood of the Sith. You've told us that he fought for dominance over the other Jedi loyal to the Old Republic. Luke took a deep breath. I need you to tell me more. How did Exar Kun fall at the end of the war? What happened to him? How did he die, or were you finally able to bring him back to the light side? Exar Kun was my greatest student, Master Vodo said, yet he was corrupted. He was seduced by the powers available to him through studies of ancient Sith teachings. Luke nodded gravely. I am afraid that the same thing might have happened to some of my own students, Master Vodo. Did Exar Kun ever return to the powers of good? That was not to be, the image of Master Vodo said. Because I was his master, I alone of the allied Jedi went to confront him, hoping that I could turn him back. I knew it was a foolish mission, but I had no choice. I had to try. What happened? Luke asked. The image flickered, as if something had sparked inside the holocron, then Master Vodo reappeared. Exar Kun destroyed me. He slew his own master. Luke was suddenly jarred out of the story, remembering that the gatekeeper images in the holocron were interactive simulacra with personalities imprinted upon them, not the real spirits of long-dead Jedi masters. Then what happened to Kun at the end of the Sith War? Luke asked. All the Jedi banded together and came to the jungle moon in a united front against the Sith stronghold Exar Kun had built. The allied Jedi combined their power into a massive annihilating strike. Master Vodo's image flickered again, dissolved into static, then reassembled itself. Which obliterated the surviving Misasi natives and, the image broke up, flickered, reformed, then broke up again, as if something were jamming it. But Exar Kun, what happened to Exar Kun? Luke demanded. He couldn't understand what was going wrong with the holocron. He shook the holocron, tapped it a few times, then set it down on the flat, hard table and stepped back to get a better view of the holographic Jedi Master. Inside the static-filled cube a dark knot appeared, like a storm gathering within its translucent walls. Master Vodo Syask Bass reappeared. But Kun was able to. Suddenly Master Vodo's image shattered into a thousand glittering fragments of colored light, as if a greater force had torn it apart from within. The darkness inside the holocron grew deeper and larger, swelling like a slow-motion explosion. Arcs of red fire struck out in all directions from the black fist. With a high-pitched shrieking noise of discharged energy, the faces of the cube split. The holocron steamed as it collapsed with a shower of sparks, a stream of black curling smoke, and a stench of melted electronics and organic components. Luke backed away, raising his hands to shield his eyes from the blaze. For a moment it seemed that a solid black hooded form like a walking silhouette rose up from the holocron, laughing in a deep subsonic voice. Then it drifted away, dissipating into the stone walls. Luke felt cold fear grip him. The small white cube of the treasured holocron lay in a melted lump on the table. Luke would have to find his own answers, and soon. Chapter 30. Luke, I've had enough of this. Luke looked up as Mara Jade emerged from the turbolift in the hangar bay of the Great Temple. She had stayed on the jungle moon a few days, long enough to learn how to use her own Jedi skills, but the incident with Kip Duran and the loss of her personal ship had soured the experience for her. Luke turned from where he stood next to R2-D2 and two Jedi trainees. Kirana T bent over to heft a pack of wilderness supplies as she and Streen prepared for a short sojourn out in the jungles. She wore the reptile skin garments and ornate lacquered battle helm she had brought from her harsh world of Dathomir. Streen fidgeted and glanced toward the shaft of sunlight that came in under the half-opened hangar door. He wore the many-pocketed jumpsuit he had kept from his gas prospecting days on Bespin. Mara walked briskly toward them, cinching her Jedi robe tighter around her waist. Luke looked at her, and thought how different she looked from when he had first met her, on the hostile smuggler world of Merkur. Mara stopped in front of him, glanced at the two Jedi trainees waiting to depart on their jungle trek, then ignored them completely. I can't deny what I've learned here, Luke. But Talon Card gave me control of the Smuggler's Alliance, and I've got too much to do. I can't just meditate all day long. Her narrow chiseled face seemed flushed even in the dim light. I need to send for another transport to get out of here, since your prize student ran off with my ship. Luke nodded, partly amused at her predicament but stung by the mention of Kip Duran's betrayal. We've got a communications set up in the second tier war room. You can call Card and request a new ship. Mara snorted. Card only lets me contact him at prearranged intervals. He keeps moving around, says it's because he's afraid someone has a bounty on his head. I suspect he just doesn't want to be bothered. He claims that he's retired from the smuggling life and wants to live as a private citizen. You can always contact Coruscant, Luke said in a congenial voice. I'm sure they'll send a shuttle for you. In fact, we're probably due for another supply run anyway. Mara pursed her generous lips. It would be nice to have the New Republic chauffeur me around for a change. Luke searched for any hidden sarcasm in her comment but saw only wry humor instead. He shook his head. I don't know who you'd get to volunteer for a brutal job like that. When Lando came rushing into Han and Leia's quarters without knocking, Han Solo was intent on studying a list of interactive entertainment options for the twins. On the floor, Jason and Jaina played impatiently with shiny self-aware toys that kept trying to run away from the children's grasping hands. C-3PO stood nervously next to him. I am perfectly qualified to make selections, sir. I'm certain I can find something to amuse the twins. I don't trust your choices, 3PO, Han said. Remember how much they enjoyed the holographic zoo for extinct animals? That was an anomaly, sir, 3PO said. Lando rushed into the room, looking around. Han, old buddy. I need a favor, a big favor. With a sigh, Han turned the selection process over to 3PO. Okay, pick something, but if the kids don't like it, I'll let them amuse themselves by running a maintenance check on you. I understand completely, sir, 3PO said, and bent to the task. What kind of favor? He asked Lando warily. Lando flung his cape over his shoulder and rubbed his hands together. I need to borrow the Falcon, just for a little while. What? Han said. Lando answered in a rush. Mara Jade is stuck on Yavin 4, and she needs a lift. I want to be the gallant gentleman who rescues her. Let me take the Falcon. Please. Han shook his head. My ship isn't going anywhere without me. Besides, if you're trying to impress Mara Jade, taking a ship like the Falcon isn't the way to do it. Come on, Han, Lando said. I took you to rescue Leia when Calamari was under attack. You owe me one. Han sighed. I suppose I could use an excuse to go see Luke and Kip at the Jedi Academy. He turned and smirked at 3PO. Besides, this time at least Leia's here to watch out for the children. When the Millennium Falcon landed in front of the Great Misasi Temple, Han emerged to see Luke sprinting toward him wearing an expression of boyish delight. Han grinned and stepped down the entry ramp, his boots clomping on the metal plates. Luke came forward to hug him in an enthusiastic embrace that was distinctly undignified for a Jedi Master. Han said, "Enjoying your little vacation away from the thick of galactic politics, Luke?" Luke's expression became troubled. "I wouldn't exactly say that." Lando Calrissian emerged from the Falcon after taking an extra few moments to groom his hair, straighten his clothes, and make certain his appearance was as dashing as he could make it. Han had rolled his eyes, convinced that suave gentility was no way to win the affections of Mara Jade. Though her scalding anger seemed to have cooled somewhat, Mara still showed a rough-edged hardness that made Han wonder why Lando would get so excited about the woman who had once called herself the Emperor's Hand. With a flash of insight, Han realized that Leia herself had come across as a mixture of fiery temper and icy coolness when he had first met her, and look at how that had turned out. Mara Jade's slender figure emerged from the half-open hangar doors at the base of the blocky stone ziggurat. She carried a satchel slung over her shoulder. Lando hurried down the ramp and cursorily clapped Luke on the back. How you doing, Luke? He practically tripped over himself as he trotted across the landing pad to meet Mara. We hear you need a lift, he said, offering to take her satchel. What happened to your own ship? Don't ask, she said, then smiled wryly at him before handing over her heavy bag. So you finally found something you're qualified to do, Calrissian. Baggage handler. He carried her satchel over his shoulder and gestured to the Falcon. Right this way to the VIP shuttle, madam. Han stepped back from Luke and looked around at the steaming jungles and the vine-covered great temple. So, where's Kip? He asked. Luke looked down at his feet and then, as if gathering courage through some kind of Jedi exercise, he looked up to meet Han's gaze. "I've got bad news for you, Kip," disagreed with me about how fast he should learn dangerous new skills and how best to develop his ability with the Force.
"What do you mean?"
Han asked. He grabbed one of the piston supports of the entry ramp to keep himself upright.
"Was he hurt?
Why didn't you call me?"
Luke shook his head.
"I don't know what happened to him. He's been practicing certain techniques that I fear may lead him to the dark side. I'm very concerned, Han. He's the most powerful of all the students I've had here. He stole Mara Jade's ship and left Yavin 4. I have no idea where he is now or what he's doing." Han forced his mouth into a thin line, but Luke continued. "Kip has a great deal of power, and a great deal of anger and ambition, but little understanding or patience. That's a dangerous combination." Han felt helpless. He barely noticed as Lando escorted Mara Jade up the ramp into the Falcon.
"I don't know what to do, Luke," Han said.
Luke nodded grimly.
"Neither do I."
The Millennium Falcon cruised through hyperspace with a vibrating hum of hyperdrive engines. Lando tried to keep his voice down as he leaned close to Han in the cockpit.
"Just let me tinker with the food processing units, Han.
Please. I've memorized some programming from the finest Cloud City casinos, and I can generate recipes that would make Mara Jade float with pleasure."
"No," Han scanned the chronometer that counted down how much time remained on the journey back to Coruscant.
"I like the food processors the way they are."
Exasperated, Lando slumped into the co-pilot's chair and sighed.
"They're all programmed for greasy, heavy Corellian recipes. Someone like Mara needs exotic food, special preparation. Not Nerf sausage and dumplings with soggy charboat roots."
"Lando, that's the food I was brought up on, and on my ship, I want the food prep units to make dishes that I like.
I already wasted the whole journey to Yavin helping you scrub the living compartments in the back, polishing the hollow chest table, and perfuming the whole ship with disinfectant."
"Han," Lando said, "the ship was filthy, and it stank."
"Well, I liked it that way," Han insisted. "It was my dirt, and my stink, on my ship.
Only because you got lucky in Sabacc."
Lando stood up, straightened his cape, and smoothed his purplish jumpsuit.
"I let you win. You could never do it again."
Han and Lando glared at each other, across the hastily cleared game board. Lando kept flicking glances toward Mara Jade as he randomized the rectangles of Han's old Sabacc deck. Mara had ignored Lando for most of the journey to Coruscant. She had rebuffed his attempts to prepare dinner, find musical selections for her, and engage her in conversation. Now, as she watched them playing cards to settle a dispute over the ownership of the Falcon, she scowled as if they were no more than two little boys scuffling in a child's amusement pen. Lando took the pack of glittering metallic cards so that the crystalline faces showed and held them toward Mara.
"My lady, would you care to cut the cards?"
"No," she said, "I would not."
"I'm getting tired of this, Lando," Han said.
"First I won the Falcon from you in a Sabacc game on Bespin, then you won her back from me in the diplomatic lounge on Coruscant, and I won her back from you en route to Calamari.
Enough is enough. This is our last hand."
"Fine with me, old buddy," Lando said, and started dealing the cards.
"No rematches," Han said.
"No rematches," Lando agreed. "Whoever wins this time keeps the Falcon from now on."
"You got it," Lando said.
"The Millennium Falcon belongs to the winner to do with as he pleases.
No more borrowing, no more arguing."
Han nodded. "Loser gets a lifetime of Coruscant public transport." He picked up his cards.
"Shut up and play."
Han tossed down the cards that had betrayed him, and stood up to hide the devastating sense of loss coursing through him. He felt as if his heart had been crumpled like a piece of discarded paper and then stuffed back into his chest.
"Go ahead and gloat, Lando.
Cool-faced, Mara Jade had watched the entire game with less indifference than she pretended to show. Now she scowled as if she expected Lando to stand up and cheer in triumph. Han anticipated the same reaction. Halfway to his feet, Lando stopped and calmed himself, straightening in a dignified fashion. "That's it," he said in a slow, rich voice. "End of game. We'll never play for the Falcon again."
"Yeah," Han said in a barely audible voice, "that's what we agreed."
"And the Falcon is mine, to do with as I please," Lando said.
"Go ahead and gloat," Han said, again, using sarcasm to mask his own despair.
He kicked himself for being lured into another stupid game. He had been an idiot, with nothing to gain, and now he had lost everything.
"I should have known better than to play with you."
"Just like Vornskers hissing at each other in a territorial dispute," Mara said, shaking her head. Her exotic spice-colored hair hung to one side. She did nothing to make herself look attractive, yet somehow it worked to her advantage. Lando glanced at Mara, then turned partly aside as if ignoring her. With a grand flourish he spread his hands wide and gestured to Han.
"But since you're my friend, Han Solo, and since I know that the Falcon means even more to you than she does to me," Lando paused for effect and stole another glance at Mara Jade before continuing, "I choose to give the Millennium Falcon back to you.
A gift from me to you. A testimony to our years of friendship, and all that we've been through together."
Han collapsed back into his chair, feeling his knees turn weak and watery. His throat shriveled, and he opened and closed his mouth several times, completely at a loss for what to say.
"I'm going to the food prep units," Lando said gallantly.
"If Han will let me adjust the programming, I'll see if I can prepare the finest repast your units can manufacture, and we'll all have a nice meal together."
Han felt too stunned to argue, and Lando didn't wait for an answer. He cast a second look back at Mara Jade, as he went toward the galley. Still in shock, Han saw her raise her eyebrows and look after him with a surprised and mystified smile, as if completely reassessing her opinion of Lando Calrissian. Which, Han concluded, must have been Lando's plan all along.
Chapter 31. The hammerhead Moma Naden arranged for Wedge Antilles and Qui Zux to go sightseeing across the pristine Ithorian landscape in an open-air skimmer. On the transit landing platform, the dazzling morning sky was a pale whitish-purple with high wisps of cloud that masked several dim moons still riding the sky. Qui strapped herself into the plush vegetable fiber seat and looked into the sunshine.
"Why didn't you want Moma Naden to guide us?" she asked, studying the topographic information and the scenic highlights Naden had suggested.
"He seems very proud of his world."
Wedge concentrated on the control panel, though the vehicle looked rather simple to operate.
"Well, because he's very busy, and because," his voice trailed off, and he looked up at her with a faint smile.
"I kind of wanted to be alone with you."
Qui felt a giddy elation rising within her.
"Yes, I think that would be nicer."
Wedge lifted their skimmer off the pad, and they soared away from the great disk of the Ithorian eco-city and across the treetops. The Tafanda Bay had drifted many kilometers during the course of the night, and Wedge had to recalibrate the skimmer's coordinates. Daylight warmed their faces as the wind breathed cool drafts against their skin. They headed for a low ridge where the dark green jungles fell away into a paler forest.
"What are you taking me to see?"
Qui asked. Wedge leaned forward, staring at the horizon. A large grove of Baffer trees that was half destroyed by the Imperials during their siege many years ago.
"Is there something special about those trees?"
Qui asked.
"The Ithorians worship them," he said.
"They're semi-intelligent, like a hive mind. The greater the forest grows, the more intelligent the trees become." As they skimmed closer, Qui could see that an aquamarine crystalline forest glowed faintly in the sunlight, covering part of the hillside. Wedge let the skimmer hover as they bent over the sides to gaze down at the glassy trunks, at the smooth yet sharp webs of Baffer branches. Scattered around the perimeter, large, dark cylinders had toppled to the ground and broken like tubes of burned transparent steel.
It reminded her of the debris scattered around the site of the smashed Cathedral of Winds on Vortex. Tiny saplings like inverted icicles protruded from the rocky earth.
"The forest seems to be growing back," Wedge said. The thin saplings glowed a whiter blue than the rest of the forest.
"I see people down there," Qui said, pointing off to the side.
The smooth grayish forms of four Ithorians dashed for the cover of the thick undergrowth on the side of the ridge.
"I thought they weren't supposed to set foot in the jungle."
Wedge stared down at them, baffled. He raised the skimmer higher, but the four renegade Ithorians had already vanished into the tree cover.
His brow furrowed as if searching for an answer.
He drew in a quick breath.
"I seem to remember something about the Mother Jungle summoning certain Ithorians. It's a rare calling that no one can explain. They leave everything behind and live in the wilderness, forbidden to return to their eco-cities. In a way, they become fugitives.
Since the Ithorians consider it such sacrilege to touch the forest, the calling must be pretty strong."
Qui looked down at the burned glass-like trunks of the Baffer trees destroyed by Imperial turbolaser fire.
"I'm glad to know they're tending the forest, though." She wondered how much of the Baffer forest's collective intelligence had returned.
"Let's go somewhere else, Wedge, so they can get back to their work."
Wedge took Qui to a high plateau studded with flat gray and tan rocks, covered with vermilion scrub brush and black vines. A confluence of three rivers came together in a great sinkhole on the edge of the towering cliff, pouring into a spectacular triple waterfall that plunged into the plateau's deep pit.
At the bottom of the plateau, water spilled out of a thousand broken caves, flowing into a turgid, foamy marsh filled with swaying reeds and leaping fish.
Wedge circled the open-air skimmer above the enormous sinkhole on the plateau, and Qui gaped at the fabulous waterfall.
Curtains of spray rose from thundering echoes of plunging water.
Rainbows sparkled against the lavender sky.
Qui turned her head this way and that, trying to look at everything at once.
Wedge grinned like a daredevil and took them over the center of the three waterfalls, hovering and then lowering them down the core of the sinkhole.
Qui laughed as the thick, cold mist blanketed them, drenching their clothes.
Wedge dropped the skimmer to where all three rivers crashed against the rocks with a sound like exploding planets.
Green bat-like creatures flitted through the spray, catching insects and tiny fish that tumbled over the falls.
"This is fantastic," Qui shouted.
"It gets better," Wedge said, "if Moma Naden gave us good information."
He steered the skimmer toward a cluster of slick black outcroppings that jutted from the side of the pit.
The overhang sheltered them from most of the cold spray and cyclonic winds swirling in the rock-walled chimney.
The booming echo of water became a constant background.
Wedge brought the skimmer in among the rocks to a sheltered place where shafts of sunlight pierced the rising swirls of spray.
"Naden said we could land here."
He reached into a compartment under the seat, pulled out two translucent waterproof capes, and removed two packages of self-heating meals Naden had also provided.
Wedge helped Qui fasten one of the waterproof garments over her narrow shoulders, then fastened his own.
He picked up their lunches and indicated the smooth rocks under the overhang.
"Let's have a picnic," he said.
At the end of an exhausting day, Qui stood outside her vine-covered stateroom door on the Tafanda Bay.
Wedge looked into her indigo eyes and shuffled his feet.
"Thank you," Qui said.
"This has been the most wonderful day of my life."
Wedge opened his mouth and closed it three times, as if searching for something to say.
Finally he bent forward, touched her silky mother-of-pearl hair, then kissed her.
He let his warm lips linger on hers for a long moment.
She pushed closer to him and felt delight surge through her.
"And now you've given me one more interesting thing," she said in her quiet musical voice.
Blushing, Wedge backed away from her and said, "I'll see you in the morning."
He turned and practically fled back to his own stateroom.
With a wistful smile, Qui watched his door close.
She opened her stateroom and slipped inside, feeling as if she had repulsor lifts in her feet. She leaned against the door as it closed and shut her eyes as the gentle illumination in her room slowly brightened. She heaved a contented sigh and opened her eyes to see a dark man, rising from his crouch in the shadowy corners of the room. The looming silhouette approached her, and she froze in terror at the sight of the swirling black cape that flowed around his body. Darth Vader. She tried to shout for help, but her voice locked in her throat as if an invisible hand had stilled her vocal cords. She whirled for the door and hung in mid-stride, yanked back by unseen spiderwebs. The dark man was closer now, gliding toward her. What did he want? She couldn't scream. She heard his hollow breathing echo like the snarl of a beast. A hand reached out for her, and Qui couldn't move, couldn't duck away as the fingers wrapped around the top of her head. She felt him pressing there. The other hand, cold and supple, grasped her face. She blinked her wide eyes and looked up to see the face of Kip Duran, eyes blazing, his expression soulless. He spoke in a freezing voice. I have found you, Dr. Zux. You hold too much dangerous knowledge, he said. I must make certain no one can ever again create the weapons you've been responsible for. There must be no more Death Stars. No more Suncrushers. His fingers clamped down harder on her forehead, on her face. Her skull seemed ready to shatter. Waves of pain plunged through her brain like the claws of a nightmare monster. She felt the sharp points of metal talons scraping through her mind, digging, prying up, and ripping out memories and scientific knowledge she had accumulated over the course of many years. Qui finally managed a scream, but it was a weak, watery cry that faded as she fell down a long, dark tunnel into forgetfulness. She slumped against the vine-covered wall of her quarters. As her sight turned dim in front of her, the last thing she saw was the black-shrouded form of her attacker as he opened her stateroom door and stalked out into the night. Next morning, Wedge whistled to himself as he dressed, smiling into a reflection plate as he straightened his dark hair. He ordered an exotic breakfast for two. Qui was an early riser, especially now that she was excited about the sightseeing they would do on Ithor. Momo Naden had promised them the open-air skimmer for another day. He sauntered across the corridor, signaled at her stateroom door, and waited. No answer. He signaled again and again until, alarmed, he tried to open the door. Finding the entrance to Qui's room unlocked, he was even more alarmed. Had someone come to assassinate her in the night? Did the Imperials know her location, after all? He pushed the door open and rushed inside. Darkness and shadows filled her quarters. Lights, he yelled. Sudden illumination bathed the room in pale peach-colored light. He heard Qui before he saw her. She sat crouched in a corner, sobbing. She clutched her pearlescent hair with both hands, squeezing her temples as if trying to hold thoughts inside that kept slipping through her fingers. Qui, he shouted, and ran to her. Bending down, he took her wrist and gently forced her to turn her head. He stared into her wide, blank eyes. What happened? She didn't appear to recognize him, and Wedge's stomach sank with horror. Qui looked confused and devastated. She frowned as if searching her memory. She shook her head slowly, then closed her big eyes, squeezing them tight as she fought with her own thoughts. Tears ran down her cheeks, oozing in small drops, then larger splashes as she bit her lip in furious concentration. She blinked up at him again, finally finding the name that had eluded her. Wedge, she said at last. Is your name Wedge? He nodded numbly, and with another great weeping cry she threw herself into his arms. He held her, feeling her body tremble with sobs. What happened? He repeated. Qui, tell me. I don't know. She shook her head, and feather-like hair flowed in a slow wave from one shoulder to the other. I barely know you. I can't remember. My mind feels so empty, filled with blank spots. Wedge held her tight as she said, I've lost everything. Most of my memory, my life, is gone. Chapter 32.
Kip Duran returned to the fourth moon of Yavin, in the heartbeat stillness of the jungle night. Filled with a power he had decided to use to its fullest, he felt ready to explode in an exhilarating outpouring of the Force, but he could not let such childish demonstrations seduce him. He had a mission to accomplish, one that would affect the future of the entire galaxy. Without running lights or landing beacon, he brought the Z-95 headhunter he had taken from Mara Jade to a gentle rest on the slightly overgrown landing pad in front of the Great Temple. Kip had no interest in reacquainting himself with the other weak Jedi trainees or even with the misguided and cowardly Master Skywalker. He simply needed access to the ancient Misasi Temple's Exar Kun had designed as focal points for concentrating the power of the Sith. Above him the night sky was lush with stars, and the stirrings of the surrounding jungle wove a tapestry of hushed sounds. But the insects made their music more quietly, and few large animals crashed through the underbrush. The entire rainforest seemed stunned by Kip's return. Kip tossed the oddly glittering black cape over his shoulders. Time to be about his business. Leaving the headhunter fighter behind him, he approached the monolithic ziggurat of the Great Temple. Rust-colored vermiform vines writhed out of his way, avoiding Kip's footsteps, as if his entire body exuded a deadly heat. Chisel-cut stone steps ran up the side of the pyramid. He set one foot in front of the other, climbing slowly, listening to the soft echoes of his breathing. Anticipation built within him. In his mind, Kip heard cheering ghosts, saw visions like a video loop from 4,000 years ago when Exar Kun had found the last resting place of the ancient Sith. Kun had rediscovered their teachings. He had built great temples, establishing the Brotherhood of the Sith among disillusioned Jedi Knights. Here on Yavin 4, Kun had used the Misasi people as expendable resources, power conduits to redefine the chaos and corruption of the Old Republic. He had challenged the foolish Jedi who followed their incompetent leaders without thinking simply because they had sworn to do so. Now Kip would finish the battle, though the enemy was no longer the incompetent, decaying Republic, but the fraudulent New Order and the repressive Empire that had taken the Old Republic's place. While Master Skywalker limited the training of his new Jedi Knights, Kip Duran had learned more. Much more. He reached the second tier of the ziggurat and paused to look down at the insectal shape of his Z-95 fighter resting in the center of the landing grid. No one had yet stirred from inside the temple. A pastel glow crept into the sky at the horizon as the rapid rotation of the jungle moon brought planetrise closer. Kip continued to climb the long series of steps, staring toward the apex of the Great Temple. Kip had already struck his first blow by erasing dangerous knowledge from the Imperial scientist, Kui Zux. Only Kui had known how to build another suncrusher, but Kip, using his bare hands and his newfound power, had torn that knowledge from her brain and scattered it into nothingness. No one could ever find it again. Next, he would apply a poetic justice that delighted his sensibility, that made him thrill with revenge for all that the Empire had done against him and his family and his colony world. Kip would resurrect the Suncrusher itself and use it to obliterate the remains of the Empire. He would be accountable to no one but himself. He trusted no one else to make the hard decisions. Kip reached the summit of the Great Temple just as the huge orange ball of Yavin heaved itself over the horizon. Misty and pale, the gas giant swirled with tremendous storm systems large enough to swallow smaller worlds. The temple's diamond-shaped flagstones covered the small observation platform above the grand audience chamber. Vines and stunted Misasi trees poked up from the corners of the old stones. Kip looked skyward. The small plants and animals filling the jungles of Yavin 4 were insignificant to him. They mattered nothing in the grand scheme of what he was about to undertake. The importance of his vision far exceeded the petty needs of any single planet. As the sphere of Yavin rose into the sky, Kip lifted his arms, and the slick black fabric of his cape fell behind him. His hands were slender and small, the hands of a young man. But inside, power sizzled through his bones. "Exar Kun, help me," Kip said, closing his eyes. He reached out with his mind,
following the paths of the Force that led to every object in the universe, drawing power from the cosmic focal point of the Masasi Temple. He searched, sending his thoughts like a probe deep into the storm systems of the gas giant. Behind him, Kip felt the black ice power of Exar Kun arise, tapping into him and reinforcing his abilities. His own feeble exploratory touch suddenly plunged forward like a blaster bolt. Kip felt larger, a part of the jungle moon, then a part of the entire planetary system, until he burrowed into the heart of the gas giant itself. Pale orange clouds whipped past him. He sensed pressure increasing as he plummeted down, down to the incredibly dense layers near the core. He sought the tiny speck of machinery, a small, indestructible ship that had been cast away. When he reached the bottommost levels of the atmosphere, Kip finally found the Suncrusher. It stood out like a beacon, a bullseye in the funneling field lines of the Force. "Size matters not," Master Skywalker had repeated. Kip engulfed the Suncrusher with his mind, surrounding it, touching it with his limitless, invisible hands. He thought about heaving it back up, dragging the Suncrusher out of the depths of Yavin. But he discarded that thought. Instead, with the assistance of Exar Kun, he used his innate skill to power up the controls again, to move control levers, push buttons to alter the course stored in the Suncrusher's memory, bringing it out of its entombment. Kip continued to watch the weapon's progress, focusing on the sphere of the enormous planet as it crested the misty treetops. The Suncrusher appeared as a silvery dot, seeming no larger than an atom as it emerged from the highest cloud layers and streaked across space toward the emerald green moon where Kip waited. He stared upward and waited, opening his arms to receive the indestructible weapon. The Suncrusher approached like a long, sharp thorn of crystalline alloy, cruising upright on its long axis. The toroidal resonance torpedo launcher hung at the bottom of the long hook. It looked beautiful. The Suncrusher descended through the jungle moon's atmosphere, straight down, like a spike to impale the great temple. Kip controlled it, slowed its descent, until the superweapon hovered to a stop, suspended in front of him. As the sky brightened with planet rise, the alloy hull of the Suncrusher seemed as pristine as a fire facet gem, scoured of all oxidation and debris by the intense temperatures and pressures at the core of Yavin. The Suncrusher looked clean, and deadly, and ready for him. "Thank you, Exar Kun," Kip whispered. Luke Skywalker awoke from another series of nightmares. He sat bolt upright on his pallet, instantly aware. He had felt a great disturbance in the Force. Something was not right. He got up, moving cautiously as he sent out his thoughts to check on his students, Karana T, Dorsk 81, the new Calamarian arrival Silgal, Streen, Tion, Cam Solusar, and all the others. Nothing seemed amiss. They slept soundly, almost too soundly, as if a net of sleep had been cast over them. When he reached out farther, he was stunned to feel a cold, black whirlpool of twisted force around the peak of the temple. It stunned him. Luke sprinted to the door of his chambers, hesitated, then stepped back to retrieve his lightsaber. He marched down the corridors, smoothing his fear as he rode the turbolift to the upper levels of the ancient pyramid. "Calm," Yoda had said, "you must remain calm." But the sight that greeted him under the dawn sky nearly overwhelmed Luke. The Suncrusher hung suspended over the temple, still steaming in the morning air, resurrected from its tomb at the core of the gas giant. Kip Duran spun around to stare at Luke, his black cape swirling with the rapid motion. Stunned, Luke reeled backward. "How dare you bring that weapon back," he said. "It goes against all the Jedi knowledge I have taught you." Kip laughed at him. "You haven't taught me very much, Master Skywalker. I've learned a great deal beyond your feeble teachings. You pretend to be a great instructor, but you're afraid to learn for yourself." He looked back at the Suncrusher. "I will do what must be done to eradicate the Empire. While I make the galaxy safe for everyone, you can stay here and practice your simple Jedi tricks. But they are no more than children's games." "Kip," Luke said, keeping his voice even and taking a step toward him, "you've been lured by the dark side, but you must return. You were deceived and misled. Come back before its grip becomes too strong. He swallowed.
I went over to the dark side once, and I came back.
It can be done if you're strong enough and brave enough.
Are you?
Kip laughed in disbelief.
Skywalker, it's embarrassing for me to listen to you talk.
You are afraid to risk anything yourself, yet you want to call yourself a Jedi Master.
It doesn't work that way.
You've stunted the training of your other Jedi candidates because of your own narrow-mindedness.
Perhaps I should just defeat you here and now, and then I can take over their training.
With trembling hands and a deep-seated dread in his heart, Luke reached to his side and wrapped his hand around the slick handle of his lightsaber. He pulled it free, igniting it with the familiar snap hiss.
The brilliant green blade extended, humming and ready for battle.
A Jedi could not attack an unarmed opponent, could not resort to violence before all other avenues had been exhausted, but Luke knew the deadly potential of his most talented student.
If Kip had fallen to the dark side, he could become another Darth Vader.
Perhaps even worse.
Don't make me do this, Luke said, raising his lightsaber, but unsure what to do.
He couldn't just cut down his student, who stood unarmed at the top of the temple.
But if he didn't?
We have to send the Suncrusher back, Luke said.
At one time you yourself insisted that it should never be used.
I spoke out of ignorance, Kip said, just as you do.
Don't make me fight you, Luke said in a low voice.
Kip made a dismissive gesture with one hand, and a sudden wave of dark ripples splashed across the air like the shock front from a concussion grenade.
Luke stumbled backward.
The lightsaber turned cold in his hand.
Frost crystals grew in feathery patterns around the handle.
At the core of the brilliant green blade a shadow appeared, a black disease rotting away the purity of the beam.
The humming blade sputtered, sounding like a sickly cough.
The black taint rapidly grew stronger, swallowing up the green beam.
With a fizzle of sparks, Luke's lightsaber died.
Trying to control his growing fear, Luke felt a sudden brush of cold behind him.
He turned to see a black, hooded silhouette, the image that had impersonated Anakin Skywalker in Luke's nightmare, the dark man who had lured Gantoris into a devastating loss of control.
Kip's voice came as if from a great distance.
At last, Master Skywalker, you can meet my mentor, Exar Kun.
Luke dropped his useless lightsaber and crouched.
His every muscle suddenly coiled and tensed.
He rallied all the powers of the Force around him, seeking any defensive tactic.
With the Suncrusher looming behind him, Kip stretched out both hands and blasted Luke with lightning bolts like black cracks in the Force.
Dark tendrils rose up from gaps in the temple flagstones, fanged, illusory vipers that struck at him from all sides.
Luke cried out and tried to strike back, but the shadow of Exar Kun joined the attack, adding more deadly force.
The ancient Dark Lord of the Sith lashed out with waves of blackness, driving long icicles of frozen poison into Luke's body.
He thrashed, but felt helpless.
To lose control to anger and desperation would be as great a failure as if he did nothing at all.
Luke called upon the powers that Yoda and Obi-Wan had taught him, but everything he did, every skillful technique, failed utterly.
Against the full might of Kip Duran and the forbidden weapons of the long-dead spirit of Exar Kun, even a Jedi master such as Luke Skywalker could not prevail.
The black serpent-like tentacles of evil force struck at him again and again, filling his body with a pain like lava coursing through his veins.
As he screamed, his voice was swallowed by a hurricane from the dark side.
Luke cried out one last time, and crumpled backward to the blessedly cool flagstones of the great Misasi temple, as everything turned a smothering, final black, around him.
Chapter 33. Near the center of the Cauldron Nebula, the two surviving Star Destroyers hung poised and ready to launch their attack on Coruscant.
Admiral Daala stood tall on her bridge platform, filled with an electrifying new self-confidence and determination.
She had not slept in the past day.
Her officers sat at their stations, keyed up and anxious.
A double complement of stormtroopers marched up and down the Gorgon's halls, fully armed and battle-ready. They had had a decade of drills, and now they would use their training to strike the greatest blow they could imagine for their cause.
"Commander Kratos, report," Daala said. Kratos snapped to attention, barking out his report.
"All equipment and weaponry have been transferred from the Basilisk to the Gorgon. Only a skeleton crew of volunteers, all stormtroopers, remains on the Basilisk. Captain Mullinor reports he is ready for his final mission."
Daala turned to the lieutenant at the comm station.
"Patch me through to Captain Mullinor."
The image of the Basilisk's captain appeared in front of her. The hologram wavered, but the man himself seemed completely rigid and in control, looking stoic as he met Admiral Daala's emerald eyes.
"Yes, Admiral," he said.
"Captain, is your ship ready?"
She paused, clasping her hands behind her back.
"Are you ready?"
"Yes, Admiral. We have reconfigured all weapon systems to increase power to our shields. The stormtrooper crew has rigged the self-destruct mechanism into our primary hyperdrive reactors." He paused as if gathering courage, but his close-cropped blonde hair showed not a glimmer of sweat.
"The Basilisk is ready whenever you give the word, Admiral."
"Thank you, Captain. History will remember your sacrifice, I swear it." She turned to the rest of her crew and switched on the intraship comm system. Her clipped voice rang throughout the Gorgon.
"All hands, battle stations. Prepare to begin our run. We will destroy Coruscant and strike a death blow to the heart of the rebellion."
Kip Duran piloted the Suncrusher to the core of the Cauldron Nebula, where Exar Kun had told him Admiral Daala's fleet lay in wait. The controls of the Suncrusher felt cool and familiar as he sat forward in the hard, uncomfortable pilot seat, looking through the segmented view panels. He had helped fly the superweapon during the escape from Maw installation with Han Solo. During that battle they had taken out one of Daala's Star Destroyers. Now he would use the Suncrusher to obliterate the rest of her fleet. Igniting an entire nebula seemed like an excessive blow to squash an Imperial insect, but Kip appreciated the irony of destroying them with their own weapons. And it would signal to the rest of the fragmented empire what was about to befall them as Kip continued his purge. The Suncrusher's sensor panels became useless in the ionized discharge from the knot of blue giant stars that illuminated the Cauldron Nebula. The front view screens dimmed to filter out the blazing light. Kip stretched out with the force, dropping his inhibitions and letting the power burst from him like compressed gas. After the effort of yanking the Suncrusher from the core of Yavin, finding a few Star Destroyers seemed a simple exercise. After only a moment he sensed the arrowhead-shaped silhouettes of two Imperial battleships. He piloted the Suncrusher toward the bloated supergiants at the heart of the nebula. The titanic blue stars were huge, and young, and ripe for destruction. On a cosmic timescale they would burn hot, but briefly, ending their lives in supernova explosions that would send shock waves through an entire region of the galaxy. With the Suncrusher, though, Kip could ignite the supernovas now, rather than in 100,000 years. He stared across the soothing rainbow sea of gas and thought of the splashed color sunsets on his colony world of Deir, the placid terraformed lakes around the peaceful raft towns where he and his brother Zeth had played. But the Empire had broken into Kip's home and taken him and his family away, without warning. Years ago the Death Star had approached the quiet and pristine planet of Alderaan and had blown it to pieces with its planet-destroying superlaser, without warning. Admiral Daala had captured Kip and Han and Chewbacca after they had passed through the black hole maze, but because Kip had possessed no worthwhile information for her, she had sentenced him to death. Daala deserved no warning. None at all. Kip increased the radiation shields on the Suncrusher and approached the mammoth blue giant stars, seething in their ocean of star material. He powered up the targeting display in front of him. A recessed section of the control panel slid aside. A screen popped up, displaying a diagram of closely orbiting spheres. Seven enormous stars crowded in the middle of the nebula, circling in complex orbits as they stole gas from each other. Their intense radiation shone through the scattered hydrogen, oxygen, and neon clouds. Kip's face was a grim mask as he flicked a row of red activator switches. He knew exactly how the Suncrusher worked, he had stolen those memories from Kwee-Zux.
Warning beacons flashed across the command system panels, and Kip confirmed his intentions to the onboard computer. The torus-shaped generator at the long end of the Suncrusher powered up, crackling with blue plasma.
Kip remembered the New Republic engineers attempting to determine how the superweapon worked, how they had panicked at the sight of a simple message cylinder. The resonance torpedoes that triggered stellar explosions were dense packets of energy, programmed and modulated to make the core of a star unstable. The torpedoes could initiate a collapse and rebound of the outer layers of star material, unleashing a tremendously violent explosion that would rip a star apart.
Kip targeted the cluster of blue giant stars. He did not hesitate. He knew in his heart what he had to do. He pushed the activation buttons.
The Suncrusher shuddered as the superweapon launched 7 high-power resonance torpedoes.
Against the muted swirls of the Cauldron Nebula, he saw sizzling ovoid shapes of electric green, white, and yellow fire.
The energy torpedoes streaked out, plunging into the boiling surfaces of the giant stars.
Kip dimmed the segmented viewport and fixed his gaze on the blue giants.
The cluster would explode simultaneously, and the shock waves would ignite vast oceans of nebular material in a galactic wildfire.
It would be a perfectly clear signal to the remnants of the Empire.
But it would take hours for the torpedoes to tunnel to the stellar cores and set up the chain reaction.
The wave of destruction would boil up from the depths of the stars until a flash of incredible force spewed brilliant light, high-energy radiation, and star matter into the cauldron.
The entire sector would become an inferno.
Kip felt a cold fist clench inside his stomach.
He could not turn back now.
Once launched, the resonance torpedoes were irrevocable.
These 7 stars were doomed to explode in a few hours.
He pulled away at a leisurely pace, killing time.
The Suncrusher was so small that few sensor systems could detect it, especially within the electromagnetic chaos of the Cauldron Nebula.
The weapon was designed to flit into a system, drop its torpedo into a star, and vanish without a battle, without loss of ordnance or personnel.
A simple first, and final, strike.
Admiral Daala would never detect his presence.
Kip's gaze wandered back to the chronometer, impatient to watch Daala's ships being wiped out in the murderous waves ripping through the nebula.
He had the most powerful weapon ever invented, and he had the powers of the Sith that Exar Kun had shown him.
Where others had failed against the Empire, Kip Duran would succeed.
Completely.
As he drifted away from the blue giant cluster, he noted that only about an hour remained before the massive explosions would begin.
The waiting seemed to go on forever.
He sent out his thoughts again, wishing he could taunt Daala.
Then, unexpectedly, her star destroyers began to move.
The Basilisk and the Gorgon powered up their sublight engines and started a slow drift, aligning themselves to a hyperspace path, as if they were ready to launch another attack.
Kip felt a flame of anger sear through him.
No, she can't leave now.
He could not go back and stop the explosion of the core stars.
Daala had to stay where she would be trapped.
Kip slapped at the Suncrusher's weapon control systems, powering up the defensive laser cannons mounted at sharp angles on the weapon.
Then he shot forward at full thrust.
When he and Han had first escaped from the Maw cluster, Daala had thrown all of her fighters at him in a desperate attempt to recapture the Suncrusher.
Kip figured it would take little more than a few potshots to give her the incentive to stay around.
Admiral Daala raised her right hand, looking at the navigator.
"Prepare to engage hyperdrive," she said.
"Admiral," the lieutenant at the sensor station cried.
"I've detected an intruder."
A tiny ship streaked across the bow of the Gorgon, blasting at them with puny laser strikes.
"What?"
Daala said, turning.
"View screen," she called, "enhance."
A shimmering image of Captain Mullinor from the Basilisk appeared at the comm station beside her.
"Admiral, we have just detected the Suncrusher," he said.
"Shall we engage?"
"The Suncrusher."
Daala took a second to accept the information.
She could not answer before the small ship flitted in front of the Gorgon's bridge tower again, blasting at the turbolaser batteries. She instantly recognized the thorn-shaped ship, the tiny superweapon bristling with defensive laser turrets. But the Suncrusher's lasers had too little power to cause damage to a Star Destroyer.
"Launch two TIE squadrons," Daala said, feeling a new excitement. "I want the Suncrusher recaptured. This changes everything in our strategy against the New Republic."
The stormtroopers, already keyed up from a day's worth of red alert status, swarmed across the decks. Moments later, the bottom bay of the Gorgon opened and spewed out 100 plain-winged TIE fighters soaring through the curling gas of the nebula.
Daala watched the small battle unfold. The Suncrusher had been designed to be extremely swift and maneuverable. With its indestructible quantum armor, the superweapon seemed to laugh at the attack she sent against it.
"It was only a matter of time, though.
But why does he attack us at all?"
Daala said, tapping black-gloved fingers on the bridge railing.
"Something's wrong here. He provoked us, but he has no way of causing us damage.
Why did he call attention to himself?" she mused, "and how did he find us here?"
Commander Kratos answered her, though she had been muttering to herself.
"I can't speculate on that, Admiral.
Bring the Star Destroyers about," she said.
"Lock a tractor beam on the Suncrusher next time it passes.
The Suncrusher's pilot is maneuvering at speeds much too high for us to be certain of a firm lock," Kratos said.
Daala glared at him.
"Does that mean you're unable to try?"
"No, Admiral." Kratos turned and clapped his hands, directing the tactical officers on the bridge.
"You heard the Admiral. Set to it immediately."
"Admiral, the Suncrusher is signaling us," the comm officer said.
"Voice only transmission.
Daala world.
Put the pilot on."
With a crackle, the thin voice of a mere boy echoed through the Gorgon's command center.
"Admiral Daala, I'm Kip Duran, remember me?"
"I hope so.
You put me under a death sentence.
That made quite an impression on me.
I hope it made some sort of impression on you."
Daala recalled the wiry, dark-haired youth who had been taken prisoner along with the rebels who had blundered into the Maw installation. She motioned for the comm officer to open a channel.
"Kip Duran, if you surrender immediately and deliver the Suncrusher intact, we will take you to the planet of your choice.
You can be free.
Don't be foolish."
"Not a chance, Admiral."
Kip laughed at her.
"I'm thumbing my nose at your supposed imperial superiority.
I'll take my chances."
He cut off the transmission and streaked by again, firing darts of laser energy that bounced harmlessly off the shielded hull of the Star Destroyer.
"Tractor beam lock," the tactical officer said, "lost it."
"Admiral," the sensor chief broke in, his voice filled with urgency.
"I'm picking up unusual readings from the star cluster.
The blue giants are fluctuating, all seven of them. I've never seen anything like."
Daala froze. Her mouth dropped open in horror as she suddenly realized the terrible plan this boy had put into effect against her fleet.
"Full about," she shouted.
180 degrees, maximum speed.
"Get out of the nebula, now."
"But, Admiral,"
Commander Kratos said.
"He's used the Suncrusher," she screamed.
"The stars are going to explode.
He's just trying to stall us here so we'll be trapped."
Kratos scrambled to the navigation station himself.
The Gorgon lurched as the sublight engines kicked in, spinning the enormous Star Destroyer about.
"We no longer have our navicomputer lock on Coruscant," the navigation officer said.
"When we turned to strike at the Suncrusher, we lost our alignment."
"Get us out of here now," Daala said.
"Any vector.
Inform the Basilisk."
The sublight engines powered up, blasting as they lumbered away from the center of the nebula, picking up speed.
The hyperdrive engines were primed, gathering power.
The Star Destroyers began to move away.
Then, all the stars exploded.
Kip Duran watched the Star Destroyers wheel about and flee like wounded banthas.
"You can't get away fast enough. He smiled. Not fast enough. The Gorgon and the Basilisk began to heave themselves through the nebula at top speed, abandoning scores of TIE fighters. The small Imperial fighters veered off in a panic when their mother ships suddenly turned to run. Kip ignored the rest of the TIE fighters and punched his engines to twice the Suncrusher's maximum rated capacity, shooting straight up and out the plane of the nebular cloud. When the cluster of blue giants detonated, concentric shock waves of blinding light and searing radiation blasted outward like a cosmic hurricane. The Gorgon had managed to pull two ship lengths ahead of the Basilisk. Hauling on the controls, Kip continued the Suncrusher's race upward, confident that the quantum armor would protect him from the worst. The incredible surge of energy from the supernovas darkened his viewports to near opacity. Curtains of fire overtook the Basilisk, washing over the Star Destroyer and igniting it like another tiny nova erupting in the nebula, as the firestorm front swept on. The viewscreen blackened, but where the Gorgon had been Kip saw another flash, and then the firestorm obliterated all detail. After his screens opaqued completely, Kip used the onboard navicomputer to set a new course. This was just the beginning. Leaving the galactic inferno behind him, and awed by the power of the Suncrusher, Kip moved off to seek out those remaining worlds that still swore allegiance to the Empire. Now, without doubt, he had all the power he needed. Chapter 34. With the morning coolness of Yavin 4, Ambassador Silgal rose in her austere quarters and basked in the shadowy dampness of the stone temple. She had been at the Jedi Praxium for only a few days, but already she felt as if the whole universe had opened for her. Master Skywalker's exercises in attuning her mind to the Force had shown her how to turn her gaze in a new direction, to see things in full view that she had previously only glimpsed out of the corners of her eyes. He had given her a nudge down a long, smooth slope of discovery. The more she learned, the easier it was to learn more. She splashed tepid water across her face, moistening her rubbery skin, scrubbing the delicate tendrils that hung beneath her slit of a mouth. Though the air of the jungle moon was thick with humidity, she still felt more comfortable when she could keep her exposed skin moist. Silgal left her quarters and moved to join the dozen other Jedi candidates in the dining hall, where each would consume a small breakfast of fruits or meats compatible with his or her biochemistry. Dorsk 81 sat at a table contemplating colored rectangles of processed nutrients. Because he had lived for so long on a self-contained, environmentally controlled world, the clone Jedi trainee could not digest foods that had not been heavily processed. The gaunt, hardened Jedi Cam Solosar attempted to talk to Wild-Haired Stream, who kept flicking his gaze from side to side as if distracted. The rest of the Jedi trainees sat by themselves or in small groups, talking uneasily. Silgal did not see Master Skywalker among them. He was usually the first to enter the dining hall, waiting for his students to join him. The other Jedi trainees seemed disconcerted by the change of routine. Silgal worked the food processing unit to prepare a breakfast of diced smoked fish and a pungent-tasting grain mash she enjoyed. Finally, she asked the students in general, "Where is Master Skywalker?" The trainees looked at each other as if they had been wanting to ask the same question. Stream stood up and looked around in alarm. "It's too quiet," he said. "Too quiet. I wanted it quiet, but this is too much. I can't hear Master Skywalker. I could always sense voices in my head. I hear all of yours. It's too quiet." He sat down again as if embarrassed. "Too quiet." Tion rushed into the dining hall, clutching her twin-boxed musical instrument. Her silvery hair streamed behind her in a wild mass, and her pearly eyes were wide and panic-stricken. "Come quickly. I've found Master Skywalker." Without question, without confusion, all the Jedi trainees rose in a coordinated, flowing movement. They moved together and sprinted after Tion as she ran down the winding moss-grown halls. Silgal attempted to keep up with the more athletic members, such as Karana T and Tion. They ran through the echoing grand audience chamber where vines covered the walls and the long polished seats stood empty in shafts of sunlight. This way, Tion said. I don't know what's happened to him. They reached a back staircase of worn stone steps that led to the observation platform at the top of the ziggurat. Silgal drew up short as she noticed the robed figure sprawled on the flagstones under the sky. His hands were thrown back as if to defend against something. Master Skywalker, she called. The other trainees rushed forward. Silgal pushed through the gathered students and knelt beside the fallen man. Luke's face seemed curdled in an outcry of pain or fear. His eyes were squeezed shut, his lips were curled back in a grimace. On the stone floor beside him lay his lightsaber, as if it had proved useless against whatever enemy he had fought. Silgal propped Luke's head up, touching his pale brown hair. Rivulets of cold sweat glistened on his face, but she felt no warmth on his skin. She probed, using her newfound abilities in the Force, desperately searching. What happened to him? Dorsk 81 said in great alarm. Is he alive? Streen asked. I can't hear him. Silgal probed with her sensing abilities and shook her orange and muddy green head. He's breathing. I can sense very little heartbeat, just the faintest pulse. But I can't find him inside. When I touch him with the Force, all I find is a great empty spot. She turned to look at the others with her sad round Calamarian eyes. It's as if he has left us. What can we do? Kirana T asked. Silgal cradled Luke's motionless head in her lap and blinked her huge Calamarian eyes, unable to speak for a long moment. We are all alone now, she finally said. End of story. We hope you have enjoyed this audiobook presentation. Please visit our YouTube channel, YJK Audiobooks, for other exciting stories. Also, if you enjoy the audiobooks we create, please consider supporting the expense of our projects through our Patreon page. Those who do so have access to exclusive book series, are able to download the MP3 files for all books we create, and also have early access to our normal YouTube releases. For more details, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. And now, please enjoy a preview of our Patreon exclusive book series, Last of the Jedi. Star Wars. Last of the Jedi. Book 1. The Desperate Mission. Written by Jude Watson. Preview. The Empire has risen. The Jedi Order has been destroyed. But on the remote planet of Tatooine, one Jedi Master remains. Obi-Wan Kenobi. Devastated by the loss of his fellow Jedi, and the betrayal of his former apprentice, Obi-Wan has been left with one last task. To watch over and protect a young child, named Luke. But when Obi-Wan learns that a former Jedi Padawan has survived, he must make a painful decision. Stay on Tatooine, or go on one last desperate mission, into the heart of the Empire. Chapter 1. Dusk always took him by surprise. On this two-sun world, it started early, one sun dropping first, then the other chasing behind it in a fast slide to the horizon. Harsh sunlight gave way to long shadows that painted the canyon floors with gray. Another day gone. Another day to come. Each one the same. Obi-Wan Kenobi ducked his head as he exited his small dwelling on Tatooine. It was time to make the journey over the arid landscape of the Jundland Wastes. Time to lurk above a moisture farm and watch a small baby crawl around the compound. Time to reassure himself that one more day had passed, and Luke Skywalker was well. He made sure the door was secure. The sand people were wary of him, but he was careful with security. No one was safe from the savagery of their foraging raids. His dwelling was small and simple, a hovel, really, carved out of the canyon wall. He had made it comfortable, not because he cared about his comfort, but because it gave him something to do. In those first, raging months, it had soothed him to sweep the drifts of sand from the floors, fashion a heating system, repair a cracked wall that let in breaches of sunlight in the early morning and spew tiny volcanoes of sand during the fierce, frequent windstorms. He had found the home by accident, by luck. He had simply begun riding his EOPE in a widening circle around the Lars farm until he found someplace close enough to hike to the farm but far enough away that the family would not take much note of him. A transient, looking to start a farm or trade with Jawas, had abandoned it, most likely. No doubt he or she had eventually discovered that only the hardiest and luckiest survived on Tatooine. Owen and Buru Lars knew he was here. Their friendship with him was an uneasy one. They knew he had saved Luke, but Luke's aunt and uncle also knew the threat that he'd brought with him to Tatooine. They were aware that he came by to observe the boy, but it was agreed that they would ignore him, so Luke would learn to ignore him, too. He was grateful for their vigilance, for it meant that they were vigilant against strangers as well. And who could blame them? Obi-Wan thought, trudging through the sand. Luke had been born in a time of violence and misery. Naturally, they would want to protect him. They would not want him to end up in the hands of the Empire, or the Sand People. Or end up like Obi-Wan, a warrior turned into an old man overnight by sorrow and grief. Was there anything inside him anymore? He wondered this, lying on his sleep couch at night, staring at the rough stone ceiling. How could a being be numb and full of pain at the same time? There had been so many that he cared about. And now just about everyone he'd loved was dead. The names and faces would begin in his mind. Qui-Gon. Ciri. Tyro Caladian. Mace Windu. The apprentices, Dara Feltanis. True Felt. Their masters, Regal. Sora Antana. And the Jedi slaughtered in the Purge. For it had been just that, a slaughter, shocking, devastating, quick, but not quick enough for the victims. His dearest friends, Bant and Garen. The imperious Jocasta Nu. The gentle Ali Alan and Barriss Offee. The warriors, Shaak Ti, Kit Fisto, Luminara Unduli. And the great Jedi masters, Ki-Adi Mundi, Adi Gallia, Plo Koon. Gone. The word would toll in his head. Gone. Gone. Jedi he'd fought alongside, studied with, laughed with, a roll call of the dead that thumped out a drumbeat of pain with every heartbeat. And then, as dawn would bring a blush of light to his ceiling, he would turn, as he always did, to the last, worst thing. The thing he could not avoid looking at, the thing that gave him the most awful pain. The boy he'd raised and loved like a son had become a traitor. A killer. A monster. A convert to the dark side, a testament to Obi-Wan's failure to guide, to protect. The boy, Anakin Skywalker, had died at the hands of the Emperor, and the Sith Lord Darth Vader had been born in his place. At first, Obi-Wan had thought that Anakin had died in the flames of a volcano on Mustafar. It was months later that he'd realized what had happened, that the Emperor had kept him alive, or, at least, the part he wanted to remain, the hate and the power. Obi-Wan had seen Darth Vader's image on a data recorder he'd found in an alley of Mos Eisley. It contained a holonet report, and he had known at once, with a sense of shock so profound it had made him ill, that Lord Darth Vader had once been Anakin Skywalker. The only being in the galaxy who could understand the depths of his grief was in exile as well, and he was forbidden to contact him. Yoda was on Dagobah, living in isolation in the middle of a swamp so hidden no one would venture there. And the spirit who could help him, who had promised to help him, Qui-Gon, could not appear to him. Instead, he had only heard his voice. You are not ready for the training. But I am, Master. I have nothing else now. That is why, my Padawan, you are not ready. It was hard not to feel impatience, even anger, against Qui-Gon. Obi-Wan struggled with this emotion daily. It was his master who had charged him to take Anakin on as his apprentice. And now it was Qui-Gon who was withholding the knowledge he'd learned from the ancient Order of the Wills, a training that could bring Obi-Wan some measure of peace. He could learn to be one with the Force but retain his consciousness. Would that mean he could lose this pain, this grief? Obi-Wan wondered. Obi-Wan saw the Lars homestead ahead. He stopped for a moment to make sure that Owen was not patrolling the perimeter. It was late, the shadows long, the sun slipping behind the hills. Buru and Owen were always sure to be inside the below-ground compound by dusk. He walked forward, feeling as much a shadow as the ones that reached out like fingers from the hills. He bent down, flat against the ground, and looked over the rim into the main courtyard below. The baby had hair full of sunlight, and it glinted, even in this dusky light. He was laughing as he crawled after a ball that Buru rolled away from him. Was it Obi-Wan's imagination, or was the boy able to slow the ball without touching it? If the Force was there, and he knew Luke was Force-sensitive, he did not know if the boy was aware of it. Not yet. Not for a long time, if ever, without training. Buru rocked backward from her perch on the doorstep, laughing. Usually, she had something cooking about now, and she would disappear inside for a few seconds to check on it. Luke would crawl to the doorway and watch her. He seemed to feel a need to keep her in sight. Obi-Wan heard Buru's laughter, saw Luke tumbling and laughing with her. He was not even tempted to smile. Seeing Luke gave him satisfaction, but he had left smiles and laughter behind him, part of another life. Satisfaction was enough for him now. He had promised Padme that her children would be safe, and he had made it so. Leia was growing up on Alderaan, the adopted daughter of Bail Organa, the kindest and noblest man Obi-Wan knew, and his wife, the Queen. He wished Padme could know that her children were more than well cared for, they were loved. But Padme, fierce, sad, beautiful Padme, was dead too. Owen Lars emerged from the dwelling. That was Obi-Wan's signal to leave. Darkness was falling fast, and Owen was about to activate the KPR perimeter droids. Obi-Wan lingered for a moment, watching as Buru pretended to chase Luke inside the dwelling. He saw the light spilling out from the doorway and could almost feel the gentle heat, almost smell their food. He turned his back against it and felt the chill against his face. Without anyone noticing, Obi-Wan Kenobi walked away, into the growing darkness. The next night, Obi-Wan maneuvered through the noisy crowd at the cantina in Mos Eisley. He journeyed on an EOPE through secret trails to the spaceport once a month for supplies, and always under the cover of darkness. When he did, he always stopped at the cantina. It was a magnet for the worst of the galaxy, itinerant space pilots, adventurers, criminals. Creatures who greedily supped on gossip and rumor as well as bantha stew and ale. Obi-Wan needed to keep in touch with what was happening in the galaxy. He could withdraw, but he had to stay informed. The Galactic Senate was still operating, but it served more as a discussion group than a governing body. The Emperor controlled the majority, who simply approved of anything he proposed. Bail Organa was still there, fighting when and how he could. He refused to give the Emperor the satisfaction of seeing him resign. Obi-Wan kept up with these happenings, but he resolved to keep his distance from them. He saw the daily erosion of liberties from afar, as though they had no relation to how he lived his life any longer. If he allowed himself to feel frustration or rage, he was afraid it would overtake him. He wore his hood low over his face and picked a dark corner. Thanks to a liberal use of bribes, the one-eyed Abyssin bartender watched out for him and made sure he was left alone. Here he was Ben Kenobi, a half-crazy hermit who had no need for companionship. A drink was brought by a scurrying waiter, who set it down and ran off to service a table of traders almost ready to brawl before their multicolored concoctions arrived. Obi-Wan had chosen his table carefully. He recognized one of the group sitting next to him, a space pilot named Wheezy. He was a muscular, hairy Bothan who was known for taking on any cargo, no questions asked. He was also an excellent reporter of information who did not exaggerate. He sat with the other pilots, well into a large pitcher of ale. Obi-Wan gathered the Force to help him filter out the noise and hone in on what the pilots were saying. He listened for a moment to make sure they were relatively sober. He was used to the boasts and fabrications that made up news in this cantina. "Travel restrictions are getting tighter," one of the pilots was saying, his antennae waving in anxiety. "It's getting harder to bribe officials. They're all scared, of what, I don't know. Rumors going around of punishments for corruption." The other pilot snorted. "Bribes aren't going to stop, even in the Empire." Wheezy took a draft from his mug. "Long as it's something they get a piece of, they'll keep looking the other way." "Look, I'm not complaining," the first pilot said. "The Empire has improved my business. No more space pirates on the run to the Rutan system. But they're clamping down now. Did you hear what happened on Balassa?" "Sure, they came in and deposed the governor, stuck in their own guy," the second pilot said. "So what? They've done that on plenty of worlds. They like to tell the governments what to do. They don't like governors who actually govern." He guffawed at his own joke. "Yeah, well, they had some trouble on Balassa. Stubborn, those beings are." "All the citizens took to the streets," the first pilot said. "There were mass arrests in every city. I think they must have arrested half of Usa. I'm telling you, this is the start of something big." "I was caught at the spaceport when it happened," Wheezy said. "Everything was shut down because someone escaped from prison, and there was a full-scale alert to catch him." Obi-Wan put down his drink. There wasn't anything here to interest him. Just the usual gossip. The various crackdowns of the Empire weren't news. Just one guy, can you imagine? And they held up transit for a week. "I was cooling my heels, wasn't even allowed to leave the USA spaceport," Wheezy went on. Obi-Wan stood. The noise of the cantina engulfed him as he allowed the Force to ease. "So I say to myself, who is this Ferris Olin anyway?" Wheezy finished. "Ferris Olin." The name sent a jolt through his body. Slowly, Obi-Wan sat down again. He tuned out the noise to listen. He wasn't going anywhere tonight. Not until he'd learned all he could about Ferris Olin. Because at one time, Ferris Olin had been trained as a Jedi. And now, he might be one of the only ones left. Chapter 2. "Anybody who gets the attention of the Empire has to be brave or crazy," the first pilot said. "Or dead," the second said, and they all laughed. "I hear he's both brave and crazy," Wheezy said. "But not dead, not yet, anyway. They ordered extra troops because of him, and they'd already imported one of those Imperial battalions. He was running rings around the stormtroopers. Became a legend on Balassa. So what happened to him?" "Nobody knows. He escaped. They've got a major hunt on for him, want to make him an example for others who might try to rebel. Worth a bounty or two, if you're interested." "Not me," the first pilot said. "I don't tangle with the Empire. Even to help them. Best to stay clear. Pass me that pitcher, will you? I'm still sober." "His partner is still in prison," Wheezy said. "I guess they're thinking Ferris Olin will try a rescue, but so far, he's stayed gone." He grunted as he put down his mug. "He'd better stay disappeared. I'm making another run to USA tonight. Supplies are low there, and there's credits to be made." Obi-Wan sipped his drink, trying to make sense of the feelings tangling inside him. Ferris was alive. Obi-Wan had assumed he was dead. Ferris had been a Jedi apprentice. It didn't matter that he had left the Order at the age of 18 and had been a civilian since then. He had been one of them, and he was still alive. He had kept track of Ferris in the beginning. He'd always thought that after the Clone Wars he would contact him. After they had defeated the Separatists. That was before he understood how the dark side would not be defeated so quickly. He knew Ferris had started a business with a partner, Rowan Lands. The two had hired themselves out to governments interested in protecting citizens who were whistleblowers, those who exposed wrongdoing in especially vicious corporations. Ferris and Rowan found them new identities and kept tabs on them. Obi-Wan didn't know much more than that. He'd heard that Ferris and Rowan became officers in the Army of the Republic during the Clone Wars, but he'd never had the time to track them down. After Anakin had turned to the dark side, Obi-Wan had cause to remember Ferris. It had been Ferris who had first warned him about Anakin. Ferris, who had sensed that Anakin's great gifts hid great unrest. Ferris, who saw Anakin's power, and feared it. He owed him. "All I know is, the next time you go to Balassa, you won't have a problem," the second pilot said. "Ferris Olin will be dead." Obi-Wan sat, his hands in his lap, his mind busy. He felt feelings working in him that he had not felt for a long time. In another life, he would not have hesitated. He would have taken off for Balassa. But everything had changed. He was charged to remain here and watch over Luke. Luke and his sister were the last and best hopes for the galaxy. He must be protected. Obi-Wan had promised Yoda, he had promised Bail Organa, he had promised Padme on her deathbed that he would watch over him. "Until the time is right, disappear we will," Yoda had said. But Ferris had a call on him, too. He could not contact Yoda to ask for advice. Qui-Gon was not readily available to him. He had to decide. He had to take the responsibility. "Just as I took responsibility for Anakin." "Yes, and look what occurred because of your judgment." The voices in his head were familiar but no less real. Trusting himself had become difficult. His duty was to protect Luke. He would stay. And if he came to regret that decision, he would learn to live with it. Just as he'd learned to live with all the others. Obi-Wan stepped outside and took a breath of the cold air, hoping it would chase away the noise and smoke of the cantina. He looked around for his Eopi. Eopis were not known for their intelligence, but this particular beast could manage to slip out of constraints and wander, greedy for the sand lichen growing just beneath the dirt. Gathering his cloak around him, Obi-Wan began to search, berating the Eopi in his head. "You'd think if you fed and cared for a beast it would reward you for your loyalty, not take off at the first sign of frost. It is not the Eopi you're angry at." The voice was dry, amused. "Here you are, a Jedi Master, and you still haven't learned to correctly identify your feelings." Qui-Gon's voice seemed to come from the shadows. Obi-Wan stopped short. He was overcome. It was his master. Even just the sound of his words recalled in Obi-Wan's mind Qui-Gon's kind, rugged face. And there, the ironic twist of his smile. "You said I wasn't ready to begin the training." "You aren't," Qui-Gon said. "But you do need help." Chapter 3. "You're here," Obi-Wan said. The words felt thick in his throat. He felt a rush of emotion at hearing Qui-Gon again. Obi-Wan had ducked into a vacant building across from the cantina. The derelict shelter had no roof, so the stars shone clear above. "I have always been here," Qui-Gon said. "Being ready is your choice, my Padawan." "But I do choose," Obi-Wan said. "I want to begin the training." "I don't understand what you mean." "When you know why you are not ready, you will be ready," Qui-Gon said. "Now you sound like Yoda." "Thank you for that honor," Qui-Gon replied, his voice coming from both the stars and within Obi-Wan's own head. "Now here I am, watching you hunt around for an Eopi, which is right behind the cantina, by the way, instead of paying attention to your feelings." Obi-Wan sighed. He felt old, older than old. Yet it appeared he still had so much to learn. "The living force, my Padawan," Qui-Gon said. "It includes knowing yourself as well as others. What are you asking me?
Simply this, what are you feeling?
Overwhelmed to hear you.
That's a start.
Angry at the EOP.
Not so.
Try again.
Irritated at your riddles.
Good.
Now we're getting somewhere.
Angry at myself, Obi-Wan burst out.
Qui-Gon said nothing.
Obi-Wan's heart was so full.
He couldn't speak for a moment.
Memories flooded him, years of missions, of conversations, of the many ways Qui-Gon had helped and guided him. After his death, Obi-Wan had missed his master every day of his life.
Tell me, Qui-Gon said gently.
I'm angry at my own confusion, Obi-Wan said at last.
I used to make decisions so easily.
I knew what course to take, and I took it.
If another Jedi was in danger, I went.
And now, although my mission is clear, my mind is not.
I want to go.
But I am charged to remain here.
Luke is the new hope for the galaxy, and I must protect that.
All this is true, Qui-Gon said.
But it's not the only truth.
Hope doesn't spring from one root.
Meaning?
If Luke has a destiny, so does Ferris.
If the Empire is to be defeated, if balance is to be regained in the Force, resistance will come from many places.
All of this together will make the difference.
You think I should go?
It is your choice to make, Obi-Wan.
You must follow your feelings.
I can only tell you what I see.
I can assure you of this, leaving now will not endanger the boy.
That much I know.
The other is something that you know, too, that if Luke is to rise, he must have something to join.
So Ferris might be a part of that.
Speak of what you know about Ferris, not what you can guess.
He was the most gifted apprentice, second only to Anakin.
With so many gifts, he is a formidable opponent of the Empire.
But I would have to leave Luke alone, Obi-Wan said again.
It was a duty that Yoda had charged him with, and he knew it was vital.
You will not be leaving him alone.
I will watch over him.
He will be safe for a time.
There is danger for Luke, danger that is close.
I can feel it, but I can't see it.
I sense that Ferris is the key.
Obi-Wan was startled.
Ferris knows about Luke.
No, it is not that easy.
I sense a connection, though Ferris doesn't know it's there.
Certainty flooded Obi-Wan.
Certainty, and relief.
All of his feelings had pointed to this.
He wanted to help Ferris if he could.
Then I must go.
At last, Qui-Gon said, you speak with your heart.
There was so much more he wanted to say, and even more he wanted to ask, but Qui-Gon's presence faded.
Obi-Wan was left feeling shaky, but at least he had a direction.
He waited outside in the cold, no longer feeling it.
Customers emerged from the cantina, many of them staggering.
He was relieved when Wheezy came out alone.
Even better, he walked with a purposeful stride.
He was sober, at least.
Obi-Wan followed.
After he had gone a few steps, Wheezy sensed someone was behind him and whirled around.
Who is it?
Obi-Wan stepped a bit closer.
He had deliberately let Wheezy know he was being followed, as a Jedi. He could follow him easily without being seen if he wanted.
Oh, it's you.
Wheezy still eyed him warily.
Don't believe I ever caught your name, but I see you in the cantina.
Ben.
Well, Ben, what can I do for you?
Passage to Usa.
Wheezy's eyes narrowed.
Dangerous place, Usa.
Obi-Wan waited.
Still, it's no concern of mine, if you've got the credits.
Wheezy named the price.
Obi-Wan handed him the credits, nearly the last of those brought with him from Coruscant, and Wheezy turned and began to walk, not waiting to see if Obi-Wan would follow.
My transport's at the spaceport.
Mind you, I don't like any chatter on the way to Usa.
I don't need to know your life story, or you mine.
Got that?
I don't think that will be a problem, Obi-Wan said.
Wheezy led the way to the landing platform.
He waved at a Corellian star yacht. Climb aboard while I do the pre-flight check.
Obi-Wan climbed aboard and took his seat. Within minutes Wheezy stomped aboard and sat in the pilot's seat. The engines hummed to life, and they shot off into the darkness.
They left Tatooine's atmosphere, and Wheezy set a course for Balassa.
End of chapter.
This book is part of our exclusive series available to Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and may the Force be with you, always.